OTB AM with Gillette Labs. Get the ultimate shave or your money back. Neon Night Edition available now.
Good morning and welcome to OTB AM. It's 7:30. Shane, how are you getting on?
Morning, how are things?
Colm, good morning to you. Welcome back to the studio.
Adrian Shane, good morning.
You were trying to, he forces us before every show on a Friday morning to indulge him in some nonsense or other. And this morning, Shane, yeah, it was about, can people guess what my ring walk was for my wedding?
Apparently this is a thing before the dinner. People walk into a
Yeah, this is news
song.
To Shane Hannon.
Well, I'm not married. I'm the only one in the room.
Have you ever been to a wedding?
I have. I've only been to like three weddings.
What,
here's
the wedding?
No way!
Yeah, three or four weddings.
I'm going to touch
you. I'm going to be a best man for the first time next year, which
Whoa.
Is... And I've never even been to a stag, and here I am. Trying
Name
to
your three weddings.
Name three weddings.
Name your three weddings that you've been to.
All cousins.
The best man gig is the worst gig going.
It's
the worst gig on the day, Shane.
I'm supposed to be.
Because
you're
there's a big...
Calm me down here.
Well, you're a funny guy, so you'll be fine.
Yeah,
but like, you're the only person... And you know, who of the group of people that will give a speech, who the crowd are sort of like, who sit back and fold their arms and go, come on, make me laugh now. Come on now, tell me some stories there. Everybody else, there's goodwill towards you, willing, you're encouraging. They're laughing when it's not even funny. Whereas the best man, tough gig.
And you need the right amount of jokes and seriousness as well, don't you?
Yeah.
There's a balance there.
You can't have too much to drink before you do it.
I know, I already know my first joke. Jeez, I'm not used to talking into microphones.
Hey! Wow. I'd be like,
Yeah.
No, is anyone OTB AM?
Is anyone there? Anyone? Sports? No?
Just looking at Jojo's face as soon as aging that little gag there. Like, what are you doing? Stop. Get off the microphone. But this all stemmed anyway. I was at a wedding last weekend and the bride and groom, their entrance song was Put Them Under Pressure. I've never seen atmosphere like it at the wedding.
Fantastic.
It was unbelievable.
What a shout.
It was such a great shout. And actually, when the first bar of the song played, everybody looked around being like, oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah.
And then the atmosphere rose and rose and rose. And they actually waited to come out. So the best man and the groom's people came out first. And then they waited to come out for the first bar of the course. Oh, my God. Goosebumps now thinking
about
it.
Shout out to the couple.
Shout out to the couple, John and Laura, having a great honeymoon as we speak in Barbados.
Oh,
not watching us then, I presume. You were he was sort of shuffling through YouTube then to force us to listen to the song that he had.
Effing ads on YouTube, like it was perfectly timed. They would have started the show with my entrance song from the wedding, but
what
it was just it's Curtis Mayfield, Move On Up.
Give us a bar of it there.
I can't do it justice. And normally I have no problem singing, but I just couldn't. Like,
did yourself and your wife come to that song agreeably, or was it one person was into it more than the other?
We actually had California Soul selected right up until the week of the wedding. And then we played California Soul over and over again in the kitchen. And we're like, oh, kind of dies out a bit after 30 seconds. So we need something else. And then Move On Up just came.
We don't like Colm to analyse something so deeply.
Yeah,
we like
it doesn't surprise anyone.
We played it incessantly in the kitchen to the point where it started to annoy us, and then we didn't have it anymore. Yeah.
So I know it's a great song. I highly recommend people look it up now. Move On Up, Curtis Mayfield. Hopefully the YouTube ads won't get you.
Can you sing it for us there a little bit?
You just asked me that. I can't.
He won't.
I can't.
I'll just reiterate.
I actually have it here. Look, it's playing, but it's on silent.
Well, that's
excellent. I sent it to the WhatsApp group there, so whatever you want there, you can listen to it.
Manchester United last night, I thought, I really enjoy a Thursday evening where there's a Europa League match on or a Premier League match on, and you can sit down, you've the laptop out, you're doing a bit of prep for this morning, you're watching the game. And I thought, I'd sort of half tuned out for a while, to be honest. They were 2-0 up, they were cruising, it could have been 3-0, 4-0. I thought this would be a straightforward conversation with the lads tomorrow. But what the hell happened to them? Last 8 minutes, 10 minutes.
It's just bizarre, wasn't it?
Fell asunder.
Like, what could go wrong will go, and shall go wrong?
Two OGs.
Because the bits are the first half, you're thinking, this is brilliant.
Could have had a hat-trick in 17 minutes.
So Belzer. Eh?
Yeah, and Tyrell Malatia could have made a 3-0 in the 82nd minute and took one touch too many. And it looked happy out. Like, I went to bed after an hour and watched the rest of it on my phone and was like, oh, this is going to be standard 2-0, maybe 3-0. Mm. And then Dave McIntyre woke me from my near sleep when Sophia got one back. He has a great voice, Dave McIntyre, for commentary.
He does.
He did his job exactly because I was about to nod off and he was, oh my God, so he has scored. Mm. And then I was glued to it. Mm. And they could have won it in the end. Strange game because United started so well.
Yeah.
And Anthony Martial was brilliant when he dropped deep. That skilly did. He did two showboats in one. Soccer AM would have a field day if they could show it. The nice little flick twice, and they scored from that. And then he set up the second goal directly with that through ball. And then Jadon Sancho, who was very poor, he scored after 30-odd seconds. Yeah, disallowed. Yeah. So there was loads of chances. And Sevilla were brutal.
Yeah,
brutal. Like, their bottom half of La Liga. But it just goes to show that this, the curse of the last 10 years of United and that culture is just not gone yet, is it, Shane?
No, you'd be concerned about them. And there was so much in that game to enjoy. Gonzalo Montiel, he'd dive in every 2 seconds, he'd go down and hold
his feet. I thought Casemiro was going down and off.
He was a lot as well. And then there was a little argy-bargy, literally, between Anthony and Argentina's Acuna. The little bit of a battle there, and they shook hands when Anthony was taken off. Bit of respect back and forth. And then just towards the end, you're thinking, what's going on? Like, Bruno Fernandes' yellow card as well. He'll miss the second leg next week, and he got a nothing yellow card for handball that was maybe... The ball was smacked at him from six inches away, and he was turned the other way. So how that was a yellow card is beyond me.
Well, I think the referee deemed that it was your man was having a pop on goal, and the arm was up. And
I think I think a free kick was sufficient. Right? Yeah, funny bone,
yeah.
Funny about it.
Yeah. And then the Lisandro Martinez Achilles injury is
what I'm working with.
That was the most worrying one, because I think even Paul Scholes speaking after the match, and he was like, "Ah, look, United should be fine. This is a crap Sevilla team." They're 13th, United can in La Liga, and United can go over there next week and still get through the tie. But then you look at Rashford being out, Martinez being out now. There's a concern around Varane after the knock last night as well. Malassi's defending for the goal was
brutal.
Horrendous.
But
there's nothing Maguire could have done for this.
It couldn't have been anybody else.
There's literally nobody else in the world of football that would happen to. The header's going out for a corner.
And it's impossible to be, too critical of, I would say, Malassia for the way the goal was scored, not the missing, the getting rid of it.
Oh, that was also
the
a
second
freak
bit was
of nature,
freakish.
Yeah,
but the Harry Maguire bit, like, there's a split second there where you do see most footballers kind of have some reaction, get out of the way, rejig themselves. It does often end up in the net either way, but with him, it was a total shock that the ball had hit him straight in the head.
There's nothing he could do.
I'm fairly sure
it would only happen to Maguire that the ball would go in.
Yeah.
If that had hit Martinez or Varane's head or Phil Jones's head, it wouldn't have got in.
It's easy to rush to a lot of conclusions about what happened last night. I couldn't leave with any other sense than it was really unfortunate. You just have to leave a game and go, well, that was really unfortunate. Like, two OGs, they should have been, like Anthony's at the upright at some point or another.
Oh, it's a great effort, actually, inside
it's
the top
post. It's a repeat
post
of the effort that he has, four or five times every single game.
The Aryan Rabbit of modern football,
Cuts in off the left, curls it around. He's going to score a load of whirlies, but he's also going to miss about 99 out of 100
chances. I have no problem with those efforts on goal. He could have passed that, but it was a good effort. I thought it was a good decision to shoot because he's so good in his left foot.
And then he'd used all five subs, so he couldn't make
down to 10 men with Martinez, with his sound Argentinian teammates helping him off. The Sevilla lads were delighted to get him off. It's like their best defender.
Because there was a moment after an hour when he makes the triple sub and Weghorst is one of them, and United are 2-0 up still, and Weghorst presses Bono in the goal and forces a goal kick, and everyone's cheering, going, yep, a bit of pressing. And you're thinking at that point, well, United are going to win 3 or 4, at least nil here. So the fact that it's finished 2-2 is a disaster, to be honest.
Well, Dave and Jerry Armstrong in commentary again were saying they were sharing their surprise that Bruno Fernandes was taken off when he was the 62nd minute, and it was 2-0. It was very comfortable. Yeah. And in fairness to them, that was in hindsight. They said it then and there when United were very comfortable, and Fernandes was not happy about being substituted. And now United have put themselves in a difficult position. I don't know if the triple change mightn't have been the absolute catalyst for what happened, because for 20 more minutes afterwards, United continued to be dominant. It was only the last 5 minutes or so where it all went haywire. But now what's happened is the return legs next Thursday, and then a couple of days later, they have the FA Cup semi-final against a very, very informed Brighton. So they put themselves under pressure.
Well, Sevilla seemed to be this bogey team. I see what you did there, full circle. I was in Old Trafford a few years ago. It was 2017 when Sevilla knocked United out of the Champions League on that infamous
Jose
night.
Mourinho,
And the atmosphere that night was putrid. One of the worst I've ever experienced at a match. But the point was made last night. Sevilla, every time they've reached the quarterfinals of the Europa League, they've gone on to win it. And you have that fear now that they just something's going to click into gear for them between now and the end of the season, because La Liga is essentially done for them. You know, it's now about avoiding relegation. I think they're 5 points off the bottom three. So next week is huge.
Momentum is with them.
They are the ultimate Europa League side, aren't they? And I was only reminded of that when they got one back last night. I was like, oh, Sevilla win this thing like every other year.
Themselves and Tottenham, as Bobby Dwyer, good morning to you, Bobby, is picking up on a comment that I made yesterday, saying Manchester United are a bit of a spoof club, to be fair, Adrian.
That's what he's done there.
Lads, sorry, I'm just watching the Malassio own goal back again. It's unreal how that happens. I'd say 99 times out of 100 it doesn't go in.
It's a point that's picked up by Nigel Gallagher. He says, I like laughing at United as much as the next guy, but they were just not just extremely unfortunate the last few minutes last night, albeit from a bad Malassia mistake, and they should still go through. I'm with you up until that last bit, because I do think there's a bit of that momentum that could be with Sevilla. We shall see how that plays out over the next while. Here's what's coming up for you over the course of the show this morning. We've Ronan O'Gara live on the line from La Rochelle after a couple of very interesting weeks for his club, and I'm sure an interesting month or so ahead as well. So we'll talk to Ronan in a few minutes' time. Art McCarrick is from Motorsport Ireland and will join us just after 8 o'clock this morning to look back on the life. Awful news yesterday with the passing of Craig Breen in testing for a rally at the weekend, and we will talk to Art McCarrick about the life and times of Craig Breen after 8 o'clock this morning. Ken Doherty is going to be with us, Shane.
Previewing the greatest sporting event of the year, the World Snooker Championship. 17 days of paradise. I'm heading over next week, so...
I knew you would sell it better than I would. Yeah. Anna Caplice will talk to us about the resumption of the Women's Six Nations this weekend, and also obviously to reflect on that story in the Telegraph yesterday and the Greg McWilliams comments that followed. So Anna Caplice has been in the squad up to very recently, will be with us just before 9. And then Noz Choudry will be with us at 9:10 this morning. He's basically become a friend of the show over the last couple of months, and an expert on all things United. So we'll ask him obviously about events last night, but more importantly, that has just published his book, Inshallah United, and we will talk about that. Really interesting read just after 9 this morning. And then Fiona Tomas, who was on the show last night, she was the author of that piece in the Telegraph in relation to the RFU, and that will be with you, with Richie, from 9:30 this morning. I did want to touch on one of the other big topics of the week as well that's cropped up in a few different spheres in relation to abuse. We talk about it, obviously, being a social media phenomenon, and it is, but it's also all around us. It's everywhere we look. We've all been in company. Someone has said something that challenges our urge for inclusiveness, and we've all awkwardly shuffled when that joke gets told, that anecdote about this one time that gets rolled out, and that meme drops in your WhatsApp, and we've all awkwardly shuffled, and we've all been silent. And we weren't expecting it at that time, of course, so we weren't prepared, and we were silently protesting inside. But your silence was no good to Lee Chin last weekend, or the Leitrim lads, or the Irish women's rugby team, who were told, who gives a fuck about women's rugby? When Jason Sherlock said during the week that it was isolating, and it was embarrassing. Did you hear when he said that? Can we be open to hear it? Isolating and embarrassing. JO said that he was really encouraged by the response of Lee Chin's teammates. They didn't shuffle and they weren't silent. They were straight on it. They called it out, and it gives license to the rest of us to take our lead from them. And it's okay to learn the job for us, and it's to learn from that, to call it out wherever we see it, because we will see it, and you will see it, and you should expect it. We changed our culture in this country over the last number of years. We changed our culture with the smoking ban. We've had major societal revolution in the last 15, 20 years. We've given a basic human right to our LGBTQ plus community. We've dragged a church kicking and screaming to account over the most awful abuses. And now we can do all of that for a group that we know feel, because we've been told they feel, isolated and embarrassed. So it can be done. The GAA's ban of less than a year for racism or for racist abuse won't kick it out. Jason says that we shouldn't tolerate it when we see it, because it's isolating and it's embarrassing. And whatever the abuse, because we will see it and we should expect it and we shouldn't be silent. And they were my thoughts on the bits that crept up during the week. So if you've any thoughts on that, do fire them into us, and we are happy to read them out this morning one way or the other. So anyway... We'll go back to the game last night, because there's a lot to pick through. You know, the injuries, obviously. There was a big aspect to the narrative, obviously, at the end of the game last night about Marcus Rashford and how exactly Manchester United were going to cope with that. And for 83 minutes, I think most people were thinking, well, this is going to be absolutely fine. There's nothing to see here. They can cruise through to the end of the season. They're going to secure Champions League football. I felt a little bit with the Chelsea game earlier in the week, there was a large period of that where I thought, actually, Chelsea are going to be fine. Frank Lampard in his lovely natty baseball jacket. He's got this thing covered. And I felt a big part about that. Like, I do think that we can be in sport very quick to rush to major conclusions on the basis of a game. And, I mean, for the basis of most of last night, injuries notwithstanding, they'll be grand.
I think so. When you mentioned it, Colm, like, Anthony Martial was good. I thought very good, in fact, in parts last night, especially in his involvement in the goal. And even when he moved out wide to collect the ball and went deep, Sabitzer pulled into that number nine role and kind of covered it off quite nicely and got into those positions where he could get on the end of passes from the likes of Bruno and himself, Martial. It was working. Don't know if it works anymore with Weghorst. I think that is over, possibly. Now, Weghorst will probably still score maybe
one
or two.
Never begin, Shane, is the question. I know that you were
possibly
in
not.
A Archie Sun sort of like.
No, never with Weghorst. He was okay in like the likes of the Carabao Cup final and was involved in different moments, but his goal scoring numbers just aren't good enough. But yeah, I think there's a lot to be optimistic about for United from last night. De Gea's performance was pretty good. He had some flaky moments recently. We mentioned Martial, Anthony as well. He can be the most frustrating footballer in the world, and yet he's involved in so much that's positive in an attacking sense. Maybe his end product leaves a little bit to be desired as well. But I think there's a number of positive things. And when you see Martinez hobbling off, and you're thinking, like, they've Forest away this weekend, they've the FA Cup semi-final, they've potentially a Europa League to play out as well, all the way to a final, and it looks like Juventus possibly, if not Sporting Lisbon, in the semi-finals for United if they're to get past Sevilla next week, and then the run into the season where you're trying desperately to get a top four finish. That Martinez injury could be significant, especially when he's that left-sided centre half as well. He's kind of just blocked off that position really nicely. You probably bring in Lindelof possibly and move people over. Shaw will slot into where Malacia is, and Malacia just didn't fill anyone with confidence, I don't think, last night. So while there are negatives, I think they're still very much in the tie, and you'd expect United to get through still.
I think Harry Maguire, if everyone's fit now after Martinez's absence and Varane's fit, let's say, I think Maguire will be the chosen one because, again, to reference Dave McIntyre for the third time at the top of the show, he made a very important point, which I didn't realise, that Maguire, in the last 10 starts that he's represented United, they've won all 10 games. And he obviously represents Harry Maguire with a bit of like calamity, and I was just saying to Phil outside in the office beforehand, just like looking at the papers here, and Harry Maguire splashed all over the back pages of the English papers. He just has that face of sadness and disappointment that
it's a face he does very well, and he has it even when they win.
He owns it, and I just can't help but feel sorry for this multimillionaire. I just can't help it. Like, he seemed like a good guy, and he's always in the wheelhouse of misfortune.
Was I reading too much into it? With the Malacia slip that led to the goal, obviously they replayed on Virgin last night where they without any commentary over it, where you have De Gea shouting, "Away!" You were asleep at this point.
He woke me up.
And, you know, you were like, oh, you know, and then you could see De Gea after the game. He's like storming down the tunnel, really annoyed about something. And then you could see, was it Fernandez and Anthony who were having a chat coming off, and they were, you know, doing the whole, like, I have something really important to say here, but I can't say too much. Can't be seeing anybody. But it felt like they were gesturing about, I could be reading too much into it, but it felt like they were gesturing about Malacia's slip, and how could he do that? Like, his teammates must be going, you know, I've lost total faith in him.
Yeah.
He had a terrible time. But even the decisions of the ref, I mentioned the Bruno yellow card, but And I actually think the ref got this one right, the Lamella incident where they were checking the VAR, possible red card. I don't think he stamped down enough in order to say that was dangerous. At halftime, some of the pundits were even saying it could have been a red card, but look, it was one of those. You're not going to complain if it's not.
Yeah.
But I think you could see by Ten Hag's face when the first goal went in, his face didn't change from the second goal, and he knew that this was a wave that was just
coming. It is a bit concerning, Shane. I would say, it was interesting here, your kind of overview of the season so far. And for me, it's like, look, undoubtedly, Erik ten Hag has improved the situation at Manchester United. I don't think anyone can really argue with that too much. I know the points difference actually from this time last season isn't actually too significant, but it's just what he's represented and what he's brought, a bit of structure compared to Ralf Rangnick last season. You know, it's chalk and cheese. But the concerning thing I would say, if you're of the Manchester United point of view, is that they seem to have peaked mid-February. And ever since the League Cup final, you know, comfortable win against Newcastle. They just haven't been convincing. And obviously there was the nadir of the 7-0 drubbing at Anfield against Liverpool. But even then, in matches that they've won, like the 3-1 win against West Ham in the FA Cup, that was actually the first game after the Cup final. So you forgive them for a bit of sloppiness there. They weren't great. They repeated that scoreline in the following round of the FA Cup, 3-1 against Fulham. That's when Fulham lost Mitrovic and their manager as well got sent off. And again, they weren't too convincing. The last week's been better. They were decent against Everton in the 2-0 win. They beat Brentford 1-0 when Brentford were surprisingly poor.
Yeah.
So look, they've slightly improved in the last week or so. But the only fear, and I would say hopefully they'll replicate this, again, from a United perspective, and next season, is that for three quarters of the season they've been good after the power show of the first two games of this campaign. But next season they probably need more stamina and an improved squad, actually. There's still loads of areas of that team where United and Ayrton Hag must be looking at thinking we can do an awful lot better than this.
Well,
so I would say the report card for me is about a 7 out of 10 so far for United this season.
You're looking at a Kane or an Osimhen to come into that forward line. Could they obviously need a striker in that position? Like Jude Bellingham, all of a sudden Liverpool's not happening. He'd probably want to go to Man City or Real Madrid first, I'd imagine, but United are possibly a third choice there for Bellingham, you'd imagine.
I'll bring you into the back page of the Irish Independent here this morning, Shane. Bayern keen to swoop for Kane ahead of United bid.
Bayern?
Yep. Miguel Delaney, willing to test the uncertainty at Spurs by getting in ahead of United with a persuasive offer for Harry Kane. He says that it doesn't normally fit the youthful profile of a player that Bayern might like to bring in, but they'd be willing to make an exception for the 29-year-old. He could be tempted by that.
Just what do you mean?
England captain maybe might be the only sort of, I need to be around the FA, put a little bit of pressure on.
Yeah, unless he wants to win a Champions League with Bayern or something, potentially.
Yeah. Just before we go to Ronan O'Gara, who's here. Ready to go.
Colm, yeah.
Shifty lad. Just played those two songs here, Colm. You and your boss went with the right decision. Good stuff.
Mm.
Curtis Mayfield, move on up. The song of the day.
Also, Aidan Maloney saying that he was best man at two weddings and used the same scripted speech for both, just added a couple of jokes. It's a tight line to keep them just clean enough in front of the bride-to-be and, I presume, the general audience.
Mm.
Nice bit of advice for you there for you, Shane. Keep it between the ditches, I think, is really
right. So that's, if anyone has any more best man speech advice, please send them my direction. At ShaneHannon01 on Twitter. I'm pretty desperate. I've only got to November next year to get this ready.
November 12 months?
November 2024. I think it's November. Sorry, folks, Evan and Aisling, if I got that wrong, but the wedding will be on next year anyway, and I'll be there.
Sure, look.
Colm, thanks a million for coming in.
Thanks very much for having me.
Hugely enjoyable and entertaining, and your music, the lads make it so easy. Your music choices.
You make it easy. Thank you so much for having me.
What? 7:52, Ronan O'Gara. Good morning to you.
Yeah.
How are you keeping?
I'm trying to keep a straight face.
Have you ever had to do the best man gig?
I have, yeah. November 2024, is it?
Ridiculous, wow. Like.
Any advice, Ronan?
preparation.
he's working a season ahead of himself.
It's an individual gig, yeah. A bit like the number 10 role. Like you're like a fly half, essentially, in a big match.
No, you don't have a leg to stand on. You're way off. I'm not entertaining it.
I'm glad.
Too much. It's 9 o'clock in the morning here, 8 o'clock with you. You're going to be turning people away from you. You want more people to listen.
The usual.
One step away from a third final in a row, Ronan. This is, whatever way you look at it from here, it's you're not the plucky underdog anymore. This is exceptional form.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's why the game against Saracens was a big, big game. I think it was a big step for the club. I think it was a big step for what I'm trying to do, what we're trying to do. And it was very important. And it's why I suppose you put such an emphasis on at the defensive side of the game as well. A lot of people, players, supporters, maybe coaches, I think they put huge emphasis on attack. But like for trophies and silverware, you need a really performing defence. And we were very good without the ball against Saracens and beyond average with the ball. Because we probably left 6 to 8 try-scoring opportunities out there, which is sounds, whoa, what game is this guy watching? But when you go through it again on Monday, that is the reality of it. But it was very pleasing in terms of how we, I suppose, see the game as a collective. And, Saracen scored 10 points. they're awarded 10 points. They scored 3 points, but a try was given because of the decision by Andy Brace, who was excellent on the day, obviously, was that he saw the ball touched the line, but when Joy Neville went to look for it, she couldn't disagree with his on-field decision. So it's about the language you use as well. So that was in for some people, it's not relevant. For me, it's hugely relevant because he wanted to keep them scoreless.
Couple of tries from Carbarlo as well in that game. Ronan, I think if my translation from French was accurate from your post-match interview, I think you described him as the best number nine in the world after Dupont.
Yeah, I think for consistently that would be. I'm obviously biased because I see him day in, day out, and I probably see his professionalism. I see how he prepares. I like that in players. But also, I think he's an absolute hybrid between a back row and a nine. His basics and fundamentals in the attacking side of the game with the ball are really good, but what he does without the ball, and I think for people who enjoy probably big moments in game just early on, his capacity to chop tackle, back rows coming at him, it's a lot better than most back rows in the world.
There was a moment in that match where Will Skelton is lifted at the line out, all 145 kgs of him, and I'm sitting there when a clip went a bit viral on Twitter at some point, but it's just always funny when you see someone being lifted at the line out that you don't expect. Is that a pre-planned manoeuvre? Is that something obviously that's there's careful consideration given to before the match?
Yeah, of course, yeah. You'd like to think that it's not the first time right, live in a game.
The lads will want to be ready for that, yeah, to be fair.
Yeah, because Dunnick O'Ryan and his work and his thought process, and that gives you a little insight into how he operates. He's always looking for an advantage or an edge, and I must admit I had a chuckle to myself up in the stand as well with the getting the two JCBs ready to lift up Will Skelton into the sky. So it's even as serious as the game was, I kind of was, wow, that's, does that look right? I'm not too sure, but if there's easy ball available and when Will catches it, there are very few in the world, if any, who are better with the ball in hand. So another string to his bow and keep the opposition guessing.
I don't know. I think there was too much of a deal made about him being lifted. I don't know how much lifting was done. I think
he wasn't lifted too high.
But it does keeps opposition guessing as well, Ronan, even in terms of the next game or the next games, whether it's domestically or in Europe. Like, you know, you had the wall, obviously, and I don't know, was that Dunica's invention as well in the Gloucester game? Like, those little plays that sort of keep the next opponent guessing about what's coming.
Yeah, and also probably give it a bit of excitement to the training week if you consider what the boys face every week. You know, you're trying not to have the same Monday, the same Tuesday. If you play on a Saturday, it's the Wednesday off for their day to probably look at non-rugby stuff. Then Thursday is nearly the same session. Fridays, you know, after a number of months, years, that just gets to you. You have to bring something different. And, it was probably why the Barbarians week was very beneficial in season, just having that capacity just to see how your approach can be different. And that's why it was so great, just having such a light week and huge and high in entertainment factor and high in guys being able to express themselves. And plenty of other teams are looking at how you can score tries without kicking to the corner or taking a scrum. So the wall is one option. Leinster have a number of brilliant options in the 22 with great variety. So, I think just where you do a wall is you're kind of potentially trying to hide the ball for a little bit to give yourself a little bit of an advantage. But what you don't see is the takes that happen. Not a match day, so it's
the blooper reel.
It's a little bit of a car crash TV when you're going back over it, but you gotta enjoy those little moments, and it can't be just all work.
It makes it like a high wire act though, because it's exactly what I would have assumed, to be honest, if you're talking about the wall and the trying to pull something like that together, because if it doesn't come off on the day, like, it is a real high wire act. You're a hero if it comes off, and if it doesn't, it's like, what are they trying to do here? It should have just kicked it to the corner.
Yeah, that'll always be there Adrian, though, you know, if you know, as you know the expression, if my aunt had, she'd be my uncle, you know. So, yeah. So
what was that? Liam Brady had a very said it very famously after a game, I think, for Celtic at one point.
So you know, you're just it's what you believe in, and if you think it's going to work, then train it and then prepare it, and then it could easily, because a lot of things are becoming full cycle or full circle in the game, and a lot of things that were out of fashion are coming back into fashion, and a lot of you mean there's no way as a coach you can say that I have probably an experienced rationale above my players on something like the wall. You know, it's really, let's see, does this work together? And then if you get a good vibe off it, let's bring it in. If you don't, all right, cut.
Do you go through many things that you cut?
Cut, but like in terms of a menu, shall we say, in terms of plays, like I can remember even in the language we used to use with the Crusaders, was basically you have like a pamphlet of a Chinese restaurant, literally like you go from number one to 179 for chili fried rice.
Oh, great shout. That's the wall, is it?
That's the wall.
Yeah, yeah, so it's along that
the great
scale
wall
where you could have, let's go for option 223 on the menu this week. But like you bank so many plays over the years that you know what I mean, the perfect example is the Joe Schmidt play, is it, where he pulled out of 2011 that Ireland scored off this year in off a kickoff reception goal line dropout against Finney Beelan back into
cut inside to Keenan, was it, or
Hugo Keenan, exactly. Yeah. You know, so that's your perfect example of how big your menu can get.
Do you stay? It was funny, we had Quinny last week, I think he was talking about the trip he took to France, and I know he met up with yourself, Ronan, at one of the matches, but he complimented how calm, he said he was surprised, I think, as well, by how calm you were on the sidelines. Is that something that you've had to pre-plan, train yourself to be calm on the sideline, put other thoughts out of your mind, or is that just a natural thing? Like, it's not a Pep Guardiola animated sideline show, is what I'm trying to say.
It could well be, and it has been. I think that's, we're not robotic either, and coaches aren't either, you know, so you have to obviously channel that, and you have to work on that, and perception sometimes isn't reality, and I obviously have a very poor disciplinary record attached to me, but I think when you strip it back and understand the why behind that, I think there's a pretty good defence there. But I can't say that because I'm the person involved, but in terms of why and how I got a ban was probably because of trying to protect my players. It's always a learning opportunity, your behaviour on the sideline, your behaviour around people, and the fact that even if you're the coach, like how much information can they take at halftime and how much information can they take at the end of the game? So don't be getting yourself too wound up in the fact that you have to come up with a killer speech at these moments. I think you got to have the capacity to stay in the moment, stay present, and also what I value is how maybe the leaders of the play need a redirection or confirmation of what they're doing.
I think it's all the more remarkable that you stay so calm when you reveal that you've 8 to 10 flat whites per day, which is not easy to stay calm under those circumstances either.
I think it's when you have that and antibodies that are hard to get at, you just keep going, isn't it? Just keep drinking it. Keep drinking it till there's a system overload, obviously, every month or two. And you know what happens then. There's 4 or 5 days off it.
You have to go detox, yeah.
Yeah, because you've spent too much time running to the loo.
Well, I think we're good. For 8:05 in the morning, we're definitely getting a bit too deep in the detail here. What?
Well, you can thank Shane for that.
The Chinese send menu was...
Send in your urgent emails and points for my best man speech in November 2024.
I genuinely thought we were talking about like a few weeks down the track. Yeah, I actually couldn't believe when he dropped
it. It's a new law in OTB.
You were able to share a bit of a few words and a smile and a chat with Owen Farrell on the pitch afterwards.
Because obviously people see the scoreline, you know, but 24-10, we get a yellow card, Brice Doolan goes to the bin, they have a period of pressure. Like, in my head, it wasn't beyond the realms of possibility that this game finished 20-24 and we have to face into additional time with a lot of our kind of leaders off the pitch thinking the job is done, you know. So no, I think I was chatting to him about his dad, actually, and that's why we started laughing, I think, because I forget, obviously, that his dad is Andy Farrell, because it's crazy when you think about it, obviously, because he had him so young, you know, because I'm kind of thinking, yeah, my mum and dad haven't been over to La Rochelle, and I was saying, that's Andy, isn't it? And then he was saying, yeah. Yeah. So, hard to decipher the two sporting grades, because all I can picture when I see Andy Farrell's in a Wigan jersey and when I see Owen Farrell's in a Saracens or an England jersey, but I always forget the great story that it's father and son. You know, I kind of have a brother's mentality logged in, which it was just so natural and beautiful the way he kind of said, well, yeah, my mum and dad were coming over. And then I kind of had to, I said what I was thinking out loud when I didn't want to say what I was thinking out loud. So it was just trying to process it. And he started laughing at me. So it was...
I think he had him when he was like 16 or 17. So there's like a real sort of plenty of siblings that would be in the same sort of category. We're obviously at the business end, and we'll talk to you again down the track maybe about your own game, but how you cut the other one feels like there seems to be this, it's bizarre, right? Because like, even paying attention to whatever narratives that have cropped up around the final four teams that are there, and you kind of feel that any one of them will win it, it feels like a lot of people have fallen back into the same narrative from last year that it's Leinster's to lose, which feels bonkers given the quality of opposition that are there, and particularly the quality of opposition they're going to meet in the semis.
Yeah, well, that's people outside of any circle saying that, you know. I don't think any people within the Leinster camp have thoughts like that. Or, you know, I mean, what's happening at the minute is probably all previous winners left in the semi-finals. So they know how to get over the finishing line. So what's set up for the semi-finals is obviously La Rochelle playing in Bordeaux will be expected to beat Exeter, and Leinster at home to Toulouse, people will expect Leinster to win that game, but you know, let them think what they want, isn't it? That's for other people to get excited about. I think four camps will have a plan, and four camps appreciate where they are, and this is what it's all about. This is where it gets very exciting, and this is the, as you say, the business end of the competition. But genuinely, yeah, I mean, we played Sunday at 4:00. We play Bayonne on Saturday night. We've had 21 days to prepare for our game. So, like, genuinely, it was, I think people probably stayed in the moment for 12 hours till Monday night. Tuesday, you turn the page, getting ready for top 14, because, well, you've done a little bit of time over here. You understand the fervour and the passion behind the top 14. So, you know, I mean, it's not like you're living in Ireland where there's a priority to European Cup, obviously.
Yeah, yeah. Or you can have nearly a quasi-off week, nearly in Leinster's case. How are you calling that game, despite the tightness of it? Because you know both of those teams very, very well, Leinster and Toulouse.
It's... impossible for me to call, obviously, because I probably, when you know teams very well, Toulouse will be, have serious, they're the two teams with the most history in the competition, obviously, and Toulouse's last visit to Aviva will be top of their memory, and that doesn't happen then. A scoreline like that won't happen again. But the cohesion of Leinster again, you'd think it's a tight game against Leicester, and then the following morning you look at it, what, there's nearly 30 or 40 points in the difference. But Toulouse have players that can win on any day. That's the simple reality of it. You know, you look at their forwards and you look at Dupont, who's the best player in the world. They have Entomac and they have Ramos. They have a spine of a team that at the top level can beat any team.
There's been
Leinster at home with the followers and their supporters and their game plan. They'll back themselves, but it's a as you expect at this level of competition. It'll be a brilliant game.
You mentioned Leinster will be at home, Ronan. There's been a little bit made this week, and maybe it's because Leinster are so dominant over here that Leinster have home advantage in a final, and the final shouldn't be decided until both teams are decided, essentially. And Brian Murr wrote a piece this week which kind of hinted at that and said it should be a neutral venue. Obviously the argument then is that, you know, you have to sell tickets out quite far in advance. There's security that has to be arranged as well. Where do you stand on all this, the idea that a final should be neutral?
Well, this decision was made at the very before a ball was kicked, you know. So once you enter it, you know where the final is. Getting to the final, only two teams get there. So it's very easy, people, for throw stones from a distance. But with the level of, I suppose, interest in this competition and the growing, I suppose, interest in the game with the Rugby World Cup around the corner, there was an opportunity potentially to grow the game. You know, you could play a final maybe in the new camp, play it in the San Siro, you could play it in anywhere, probably in Europe. But Leinster have to get to a final for it to be in the Aviva. So, yeah, they play a lot of games there and it's a second home for them. But like every other team, knew that at the start of the competition, so there's no point whining now, you know. This is what it is, and we're only at semi-final stages, so I think it's very, people, you know what I mean, probably don't underestimate how good Toulouse are. Yeah, Leinster are in Dublin and they were a lot more organised for them the last time they played, but sport can change quickly and depends on the moment. You know, you've seen enough of examples of that throughout the years that you have no idea who's going to be in the final yet.
Yeah, it could become a very moot conversation in 12 days' time. We'll see how it pans out over the next few weeks. We'll come back to you again, Ronan, maybe in about 12 months' time to ask if you have any more tips for Shane on the best man.
Have a think there, Ronan, for about a year and a half maybe.
And the calendar's a little less busy. Thanks a million.
See you guys. Bye-bye.
Ronan O'Gara on the line there from La Rochelle. Honestly, I'm with him. Like, I thought we were chatting about something that was on the horizon.
Still, it's my first time doing it, Adrian. You know, you're under pressure. First time for anything is nerve-wracking.
That is, no, I'll give you that. It's just, it's very, very far away. I did a This Is Your Life themed best man gig, says Shifty Led, more than Shifty. Yeah, I was about to get into that, and then I just did a little bit of a forward read there. And
have you ever done
some
one?
Of these are quite edgy. I've done three of them.
Oh, you've done three of them?
Yeah.
So I'm talking to the right man here.
Well, come back to me in 12 months.
Did you just use the same speech and rehash it?
No, I did one of them when I was much younger, and it was a scarring experience.
Lead balloon job.
I'll talk to you about it. Absolutely. I'll talk to you about what not to do.
Right. That's all I need.
No doubt about that, as the great man would say. Right, we've loads still to come on the show. We're going to be talking to Ken Doherty in a little bit. We're going to have Anna Caplice, obviously looking ahead to the weekend's Six Nations. And Noz Choudry is going to join us as well after the release of his new book. We're back after these.
OTB AM.
The Sports Breakfast Show from Off the Ball.
Off the Ball will be hosting a live UEFA Champions League roadshow in partnership with Just Eat. And it's coming your way on May 3rd, live from the Mansion House in Dublin.
We'll be joined by some great guests, including UEFA Champions League winner John O'Shea.
Our guests will share memorable stories and reminisce about their careers.
We'll also look ahead to the latter stages of the competition.
This is an exclusive off-air event and tickets are limited, so don't delay. Go to offtheball.com/events and we'll see you on the night.
Just Eat, the official food delivery partner of the UEFA Champions League.
Fighting Words, Ukrainian Action in Ireland and the Irish Red Cross have come together to host an exciting concert by some of the best loved artists from both Ireland and Ukraine at Vicker Street on Monday, 24th of April. Come show your support with more than 20 great Irish and Ukrainian artists, including Glenn Hansard and Colm McInumra, Cathy Davey, Roddy Doyle and Paul Muldoon, all taking part in support of the millions who have been forced to flee Ukraine. A concert for Ukraine at Vicker Street, Monday, 24th of April. Tickets on sale from Ticketmaster at just €25 or go to VickerStreet.com.
OTB AM with Gillette Labs. Get the ultimate shave or your money back. Neon Night Edition available now.
You're based in Andorra, not bad.
Yeah, not bad, not bad. I still miss the old, you know, the green grass. I love it in Andorra. The drivers, I think 30% of the MotoGP field live in Andorra, so it's a high octane country. I've got the best of both worlds. I'm learning to ski at the moment.
How's that going?
It's tricky. The paddies and the snow wouldn't be the May West, I'd say. But, I'm learning, and then in the summertime, you've got beautiful, you know, golden sunshine nearly all summer long, and warm temperatures is perfect for me for training. So I love it. Come back here as often as I can, but I have to say it does feel like home.
And just out of interest, do you get that same buzz off taking to the slopes in Andorra as you do, say, being out there in a rallycross car, or are you still very much, once you're in the car, nothing can come close to that?
To be honest with you, the speed I'm going on the slopes now, I have the two skis welded like this, and I'm doing about 2 miles an hour going down, so maybe ask me again, and I was going to say 6 months, maybe 6 years' time, I might be after improving a small bit. But I enjoy it, and it's a great way of getting fit as well, and we can do ski-mo as well, which is where you put the rubber ends onto the skis, and you can actually climb up as well, so I use it for training, so... not quite the same with joining the Russia's rallying, but maybe in the future.
Desperately sad stuff. It was Owen in conversation with Craig Breen from a couple of years ago. He had joined us on OTB AM over the years to talk about where he was at in his career, and desperately sad news with his passing, and we wanted to mark it, and to do that I'm delighted to say we're joined on the line in sad circumstances by Art McCarrick, who's the sporting manager at Motorsport Ireland. Art, thanks a lot for taking the call this morning. Just when you watch back the video, it just hammers home what a tragic event that occurred yesterday.
It really does, and it's hard to believe we're talking about Craig Breen in the in the past tense. You know, he was our most successful, most talented, most decorated driver, and you know, the whole motorsport community is really struggling to to come to terms with the news we got yesterday.
And a guy that, I think there is an acceptance from people who compete in a sport like that about the dangers that are involved, but just the event itself is equally so unthinkable.
It really is, and, you know, look at the Croatian authorities and Hyundai will have to do the necessary investigations there, and really at the moment, you know, our thoughts and concerns are with Greg's immediate family and his co-driver James Fulton, who thankfully got out of yesterday's accident unscathed, and just the sheer outpouring of grief among the Irish motorsport community and the wider sporting community has really been something to behold. He was one of those motorsport figures because of his profile. He kind of transcended motorsport a little bit. People who didn't know anything about motorsport knew who he was. Yeah. And it's a tough day.
Will you talk to us a little bit, Art, if you can, about who he was as well? I'm sure you would have had plenty of dealings with him over the years. The little bits that we would have chatted to him about, his crazy passion for motorsport across the board, really lifted off the page. But will you talk to us a little bit about that and about who Craig Breen was as a person?
Yeah. So his father was a former national rally champion. So Craig grew up around the sport, and he started go-karting from the age of 8. And after 2 years, he was the national junior champion. And in 2008, he decided he would leave the karting, which he was very talented with. And once he was old enough to get his road traffic license, he went rallying, and his trajectory really from 2008 was nothing short of spectacular. His first full year rallying in 2009, he was the Irish junior champion, Irish and UK Fiesta sporting champion, Billy Coleman award winner, the youngest person ever to win that. The following year, he won the Pirelli Star Driver Global Shootout. 2011, he won the Academy section of the World Rally Championship that got a €500,000 prize at the time. 2012, he won the second tier of the World Rally Championship. And since 2013, effectively, he had been a full factory driver with Peugeot first, then with Citroën, then with Hyundai, then with Ford, and tragically back to Hyundai, where it's all finished up. And his achievements, we'll talk about the man in a second. He won 5 European Rally Championship events, had 9 World Rally Championship podium finishes, including 6 second place finishes. No Irish driver has ever got close to that. I'm not sure they ever will. He was very close to getting on the top step of the podium. Indeed, he was strongly fancied in Croatia. He had a very good result in Sweden on his first round of the championship this year with the new co-driver. But he loved motorsport and loved loved helping others kind of try and get the opportunities that he got. In fact, only this year he sponsored the Junior 1000 Rally Championship, which takes place in the forests for drivers aged 14 to 18, and he put up €10,000 sponsorship money. And as recently as 3 days ago, Tuesday, he attended a tuition day for those drivers, 18 young drivers in Galway, and they didn't even know he was going to come. And it was just unbelievable.
He was clearly very, very humble, Art, and such a role model to those young drivers. I even saw some Instagram posts yesterday from the likes of Alex Dunn and even James Rowe, who's over in Indy, who clearly looked up to him. A lot of the Irish young drivers, in fact, all of the Irish young drivers did. And even that interview with Owen that we played beforehand, like, if you watch the full thing back on YouTube, you'll see he talks about his demons as well, and some of the dark days over the last, you know, number of years, and dealing with those, and speaking to family and professional help as well. So he was clearly quite comfortable in that role model role, and knew that maybe speaking out about the likes of that was crucially important as well.
Yeah, you know, so many, and you probably speak to them a lot, so many top sports people there, they can kind of be a bit robotic in their answers sometimes, or a little bit guarded. That certainly wasn't Craig. He was always very honest, but possibly sometimes too honest. But it was always he couldn't hide who he was, and he was, you know, as we said yesterday in our statement, he was a world-class driver, but he was a world-class person as well.
Clearly, and if anyone has seen Craig's Twitter bio, you'll have seen reference to Jaffa, and Gareth Roberts is a Welsh co-driver known by the name Jaffa. And I think it was in 2012 that Gareth Roberts was tragically killed in an eerily similar crash to yesterday's, and that was clearly something that had affected Craig quite deeply, Art, as well.
It was, and he spoke very openly about that. I think that accident was June 2012. But I suppose if you wanted a measure of the man, the first event Craig did after that accident was a small rally in Wales. And the person who sat in as the co-driver was Gareth Roberts' brother. And it really was just a measure of the man that, you know, we all know the risks in the sport, but it doesn't make it any easier on days like this. But the fact that, you know, Gareth Roberts' brother sat in with Craig for his first event back, that speaks volumes about who he was and how he was respected.
That speaks volumes, I think, doesn't it?
Yeah, world class, as you said, Art, world class driver and world class individual as well. And I was struck, absolutely. You mentioned Rally Sweden earlier, I was struck by his words now that the clip was doing the rounds yesterday, where he had said it's an incredibly tough sport to get a seat in. And he was very open again about his ups and downs in relation to that. And he was obviously back and felt back and had said, don't let anyone put you down, only you know your true potential. And there are words that ring heavy today.
Absolutely. You know, there's less seats at the top of the World Rally Championship than there is in Formula One. You know, there's only three teams and not all of them run three cars. Craig had done the deal with Hyundai this year to share a third car with Danny Sordo, and the hope was that would turn into another full-time seat next year. And he worked every second of every day to get back to the top. In fact, late 2018, his contract with Citroën had finished. He didn't have a factory drive in himself, and his co-driver at the time, Paul Nagel, pulled together sponsorship to do the Irish Tarmac Championship at home, which was always a dream of Greg's to do. But he realised that he only had a finite amount of time at the top level of the sport, so it was something he never really chased. But he annihilated the opposition here at home in 2019, and halfway through that season Hyundai came knocking, and that was the restart of his career at the top level. And he like I say, he was incredibly open about the difficulties and the pressures of being not only a professional top flight driver, but the pressures of being a top flight sports person. You know, he divided his time between the continent and Ireland, and would come back as much as he could. And even this year, you know, he competed in two events in Ireland in 2023, the West Cork Rally, not that long ago, St. Patrick's weekend, and a very small navigation trial event in County Cavan, which would be the home club of James Fulton, his co-driver, just to try and, you know, build that relationship up with James as a new co-driver for this year. And he did so much outside of the sport too. You know, he was an ambassador for the Road Safety Authority in conjunction with ourselves for, you know, promoting the Keep the Race in Its Place message. And you know, I was just listening earlier on this morning, those kids talking about playing GAA in front of Joe Biden and the buzz it gave them. I just couldn't stop thinking of Tuesday had just gone, where, you know, he rocked up to the tuition day where his young drivers had an idea he was going to turn up, and it was right up until the very end. One of the greatest advocates for Irish motorsport you'd ever meet.
I think that's so important what you said there, Art, about the fact that he never forgot his roots. I know he was a Waterford man, and you listed off his achievements there earlier, and as you say, it'll be very difficult for any Irish driver ever to match them, never mind surpass them. But the fact that he came home, as you said, to you know, Irish Tarmac Championships, whether it be in Killarney or Donegal or wherever, or Cavan, as you say as well, that also speaks volumes, because he didn't have to come home for those events.
No, but he wanted to, and he never forgot what made him love the sport, and that was, you know, the Irish events here. And he knew that that's what made him happiest, I suppose. When he was competing here, it was stress-free competing, I suppose, at the level he's at. But he made a conscious effort in recent years, especially to come back here and compete, or even spectate. You know, you could see his head sticking out of a hedge at any corner of the country. He got back whenever he could, and the fact then in later years he started giving back and mentoring young drivers was just a whole different element, because he was lucky enough he found himself in the position to do that. And yeah, he didn't have to, no one asked him to. It was just something he wanted to do. And he leaves behind an amazing legacy, albeit tragically cut short.
Yeah, well, our thoughts are with the Motorsport Ireland community today, Art, and with his family and his friends, of course, as well. It's awful news, and we didn't want to let it pass without reflecting on who he was. So I know it was tough for you to do that over the last 10 or 15 minutes, but we appreciate it. Thanks a million.
No, absolutely. Thanks very much, guys.
Thanks a lot, Art McCarrick there at Motorsport Ireland. We'll be back after these.
De Laurentiis is one of the toughest negotiators in Italy. You know, I wouldn't want to do a deal with De Laurentiis, any kind of deal, because I think I might be in the losing side. But you're absolutely right. Napoli are not in the position that they need to sell to fund their success. They are financially viable. In the summer, by selling or letting go those players that we mentioned before, they managed to reduce their wage total, so they really don't have to make a lot of money. They will receive money anyway by winning the Scudetto, by qualifying for the quarterfinal of the Champions League, and maybe even more. So I think they could look at the future in a way that actually they could strengthen the team. They've extended the contract of Kvaratskhelia for another 3 years. Osimhen is still tied to a contract until 2025, so they don't need to sell it this summer. Maybe next summer, unless they manage to extend the deal, but the price will be astronomical. And they also, manage to get players relatively on the cheap. You know, Zambuanghissa, for example, wasn't doing it at Fulham. He got relegated, and they got it relatively cheap. Same with the Lobotka, whose value has increased. Kim values has increased as well, but I think they will keep it at least for another season. For them to have the chance to defend the Scudetto properly, and let's see how it goes in the Champions League, but obviously they will be seeded this time in this group of the Champions League as Italian champions, so they will have an early draw, easy draw, etc., and all the ramifications. But Napoli, they don't look like they need to. There are other teams in Italy that got other financial issues, and is always one in, one out, but not for Napoli.
8:30, still loads to come. Anna Caplice is going to join us to talk about Six Nations shortly, and we'll be joined a little bit later on by Nardine Choudry to talk about his new book, Inshallah United. And United is very much the... Ken Doherty will be with us in a couple of moments, by the way. And United very much the topic and the tone across the back pages this morning. Mad United, says the back page of The Sun. And you've got Harry Maguire, a hapless looking Harry Maguire, after nodding the ball into the back of his own net last night, unbeknownst to himself.
Poor Harry.
As we said at the top of the show, really, it could only happen to him. The Lions person and Andy Robertson have made up. And your man has been cleared. No wrongdoing. Was trying to extricate his arm from the other lad is basically what
a big baby.
Yeah, a big baby. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Sabotage, another good headline on the back page of the Star this morning in relation to Man United. Byron Keane to swoop for Kane ahead of United bid. An interesting line from Miguel Delaney there. And Colm Keyes also writing that the referees committee have hit back over Fergal Horgan's appointments claim from earlier in the week, and plenty more as well across the back pages this morning.
Yeah, 8:32 a.m. though on this Friday morning's OTB AM. And tomorrow is the start of, as I said, the greatest thing in sport. The World Snooker Championship gets underway at the Crucible. 17 days of brilliance. Looking forward to heading over to it. Delighted to be joined by the 1997 World Snooker Champion, Ken Doherty. Morning, Ken. How are things?
Morning, Shane. How are you?
It's like Christmas Eve, Ken.
You love it.
I'm looking forward to heading over. It's going to be exciting. And I'm trying to pick out winning qualities and winning qualities of players. Can you last the pace? Can you last the 17 days? Are you in form? But I mean, if you look at your win in 97, Ken, you actually don't have to be in form to win the World Championship.
Well, this is it. Yeah, I mean, it's because it's over the best of 19 and then 25, of course, until the semi-final. Excuse me. You can find your form there. I think it's an interesting point because I think a lot of players are coming into the World Championship, particularly the defending champion, Ronnie O'Sullivan, without any form. You know, you've got him, you've got Trump, and you've got Robertson in there. No real form at all. So they'll be helping to find their form at the World Championship, which is quite unusual.
So coming into tomorrow, and Ronnie O'Sullivan, as you say, defending champion, so he'll be in action at 10 a.m. tomorrow in the opening session with Pang Jung Zhu, his first opponent. Could potentially face Ding Jun Wei in the second round, so we're looking forward to that one. But yeah. Ronnie, so after that World Championship win last year, Ken, he wins the Hong Kong Masters, the champion of champions, beats Joe Trump, in fact, easily in that final.
Yeah.
But regardless of, as you say, form or lack of it, Ronnie is still, you'd imagine, the man to beat, and this could be history. He's level with Stephen Hendry and looking to overtake him.
Yeah, he's on 7 with Stephen Hendry, achieved that last year, beat Trump in the final. He's looking to make it 8, which is unprecedented, so that would be a new record, which adds a little bit of pressure as well, but I think he enjoys that. I think he likes the thrill of it, and he is the man to beat. There's no doubt about it. I mean, all the rest of the other guys will be, you know, watching him and see how he's performing. So difficult to play at the World Championship because he sort of feels at home there. You know, previous years, he was complaining about the sort of longevity of the tournament over 17 days, you mentioned, and sometimes he gets a bit bored or, you know, impatient, and then sort of, you know, throws his toys out of the pram in a few matches over the years. But I think over the last couple of years, he sort of set his goal on, you know, creating that legacy and wanting to be the best, without doubt. And that's what he's after. He's after number 8, you know, without a shadow of a doubt. And I hope he does it because I think his talent deserves it, you know.
Sometimes, Ken, you have these conversations, like we had Johnny Sexton in the Six Nations overtaking Ronan O'Gara as the points leader, and Owen Farrell is probably going to do it at some point or another. So you have these conversations about, like, who's the GOAT in that context. And even though he's level with Hendry at the minute, it does feel like there isn't really a conversation to be had that everybody accepts that it is.
Yeah, true enough. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he's won 7 UKs. He's won 7 Masters, which is better than Stephen Hendry. Stephen was 6, I think, and 5, respectively. Or 6 Masters and 5 UKs. So, without a doubt, I mean, he's the most talented player that we've ever played. You know, left-handed, right-handed, the amount of breaks, I mean, almost 1,200. I think centuries. Hendry was on 7-7, I think. So he's broken all the records. And, you know, he's the most, as I said, the most naturally gifted player that the game's ever seen. So I think everybody regards him as the GOAT. There's no doubt about that. But I think he'd still like to get that 8 just to say, look, I've got more than Stephen Hendry now at the World Championship. He's level with him, as I said. Steve Davis had 6. And I think, it's a born in a desire for him to win that number 8. And it could be this year.
We talk often on the show, Ken, about this strange intangible in sport, momentum, and it feels like in years where Ronnie gets past the first or second round, like I remember him exiting, I think, at the first round to James Cahill. Ali Carter, I think, was in the second round not too long ago as well. Yeah. So do you almost feel like when he gets beyond those first round, a couple of rounds, that's when you realise, okay, Ronnie's head is really in this?
Absolutely. I think the first couple of rounds, I think he's most vulnerable. I don't think he'll have too much problem with the qualifier, Pang Jung-ju, even though he's up and coming, young Chinese lad from Sheffield here. Might cause him, just because of the sort of pace that he plays there. But I think his danger could be in the second round. I'm looking at the draw here, Ding Junhui or Hussein Bafai in the second round. That could be a danger, but that would be over 25. I think when he gets by there, he'll possibly play Mark Williams in the quarterfinals, which would be a fantastic match. And then the possibility of Judd Trump or Sean Murphy, maybe, or Jack Lazowski in the semifinals, which again would be, you know, a mouth-watering prospect, you know, for Trump. Trump and him played in the final last year. Murphy is playing really, really well. Just won the tour championships only a few weeks ago, playing superb, back to his best. So he could pose a big problem for him as well.
Yeah, and I guess from an Irish perspective, and we'll touch on Mark Allen in a second, but I guess we're claiming Sean Murphy as well, given that he's living in living in Dublin now. He's got
Irish
family.
He's living in Mount Barnum now. Yeah,
exactly. Sort of, we'll take him.
More or less an Irish man now, living in Dublin and loving it, travelling back and forth. And yeah, he's very proud of his Irish roots, actually, you know, he, even though he was born in England, but he is very proud and he loves living in Ireland. And yeah, it's good to see him back playing well. I mean, he's won a couple of tournaments now this year. It's great to see him playing back to his best, like, you know. So he would be a big danger, I think, as well.
I was over in Wolverhampton to watch bits of the Players' Championship and the form he was in at that, and as you mentioned, the Tour Championship as well. Ken, like, he's scoring better than anyone at the moment. He doesn't seem to feel pressure whatsoever. Got to the final in 2021. There's just something different about Sean Murphy. He's probably the informed player in the world right now, would you say?
I'd say so, yeah. And he must be coming into this World Championship with a lot of confidence, you know, the way he played in the players and indeed in the Tour Championship particularly. You know, it was a fantastic run, and just the manner in which he won it as well, you know, even when the pressure came on from Wilson. You know, he just went up another couple of gears. So his long ball game is back, which was sort of, by his own admission, wasn't great over the last couple of years. But and he's scoring a lot heavier now as well. So, yeah. And he plays the game flamboyantly, you know, very fluent, quick around the table, great break builder. And one of the best cues that we have in the game as well. So, yeah, it's good to see these players playing well. But, I mean, when you look down the list, I mean, himself, Mark Allen, that you mentioned, who's had a fantastic season as well. Selby, he could be a danger. He's down in the bottom half of the draw. You know, he's a four-time winner. But the rest of them, you know, the Trumps, and as I said, the Robertson, John Higgins and Mark Williams and O'Sullivan haven't really performed over this last, like, 12 months. So they're, you know, they have the experience of being there and winning the trophy, but you know, they'll have to find their form at the World Championship. So it's going to be interesting from that perspective.
You mentioned Mark Allen, someone who's never won the World Championship, but if you look at his campaign this year, he's won the Northern Ireland Open, the UK Championship, the World Grand Prix. It's tailed off a little bit, possibly, since a few of those victories, but he's clearly a man, when you listen to interviews, Ken, recently, that has so much confidence. He's clearly visibly lost a hell of a lot of weight, and I think he gives Ronnie O'Sullivan a lot of credit for helping him out in that regard as well. But he's in a good place, Mark Allen.
Yeah, he is, yeah. I mean, he's lost nearly 6 stone since last summer, which is incredible. And that will definitely help him at the World Championship, you know, not carrying that weight. Because not only is the World Championship over 70, it's a marathon. And it's a marathon of the mind as well and the body, you know, because the pressure does take it out of you physically. And the fact that he's, you know, he's fitter, he's a lot lighter, he can reach, you know, more shots even on the table. But I think you're not carrying that weight over the 17 days has to help him. And yes, he hasn't got his hands on the World Championship yet, but I think he has a really good chance this year. He's playing superbly well, you know, winner of three tournaments, the most consistent performer over the 12 months as well since we came back. And I think he's going to be a big danger man in the bottom half of the draw.
And you look at Mark Allen's route, I'm just looking at the draw here. So he's got Fang Zhengyi in the first round, a possible clash against Bingham or Gilbert in the second round, and then you'd imagine Neil Robertson or Ali Carter awaiting in a quarterfinal. So not an easy half of the draw, but it's still, there are matches and opponents that Allen would fancy himself in.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. It's interesting. I mean, some of the young qualifiers, you know, the Chinese lads, I think we've got five of them there. Wu Yis and Feng Shengji that you mentioned as well, wonderful players, you know, and Si Jia Hui as well. I hope I got those pronunciations correct. But yeah, wonderful players, young Chinese talent coming through. But yeah, I mean, it's not a bad draw for Mark Allen, to be honest, you know. And the big match would probably be Bingham or Gilbert, could pose a little problem to him. But the quarterfinal, yeah, Ali Carter or Robertson. And Ali Carter is probably coming into the World Championship with a lot more form than he has done over the previous seasons. So that might be, you know, that match against Robertson, should the two of them get through, that should be a right cracking match as well, but over the best of 25.
You look at Selby, and you mentioned him, Ken, like, as you say, same section of the draw as Higgins and Wilson. Selby, he won the English Open before Christmas. Maybe the form hasn't been as good, but in that tournament he beat the likes of Higgins and Ali Carter and Pang Zhengzhu, who Ronnie plays in the first round.
Yeah.
So Selby, you can never rule out at this tournament particularly.
No. And for me, actually, he's going to be my pick, you know, this year. There's something about Selby this year. As you said, he's won two ranking tournaments, one just a couple of weeks ago in Leicester. And at the Tour Championship, he lost to Corin Wilson. But he has shown a lot more form. You know, he's had his mental health issues away from the table and some family problems. His wife hasn't been too well. He's had that to deal with, but he's okay now. And he looks a lot happier. And particularly around the table, he seems to have got his confidence back. His scoring is back to his best. And I think he could be the dark horse of the tournament. He's going to be my pick and my sort of, he's the only one, I think. And he's the one that, even if he gets to the final, and O'Sullivan gets to the final. It's one player on the whole circuit that O'Sullivan hates playing is Selby. He's called him the torturer over the years, you know, and he doesn't like playing. They've had some great matches. Yeah, Selby has beaten him from 10-4 down, I think, at the World Championship Finals 1 year. And then, of course, on his way to winning his seventh, I think I saw our sixth, O'Sullivan beat Selby in an epic semi-final, 17-16, coming from 16-14 down. Mm. So they've had some tremendous matches at the World Championship. But he is the one player that I think Ronnie wouldn't like playing in the final.
He's the only man that Ronnie, of course, has lost to in a final at the World Championships as well. So that backs that up. Neil Robertson is a man who Selby could meet potentially in a semi-final this year, Ken, if they both went the distance. But when you think back to Robertson's World Championship win, that's 2010, that's 13 years ago. You know, if he ends up ultimately retiring with just one world title to his name, that would be hugely surprising for a player of his talent. He probably adds a lot of pressure on himself heading into the Crucible because he only has the one world title, as you say.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't knock just one world title.
No, they're absolutely fine. You got to a couple more finals as well, Ken, to be fair.
Wow, shade drawn, Ken.
Now, I mean, I think you're right. You know, for someone as talented as him, and he's one of the best players that's ever played the game, there's no doubt about that. And, you know, he's just wonderful, cuist and score, you know, the centuries. And yeah, I mean, 13 years, it's a long time. You know, when he won that championship in 2010, for sure, I mean, I thought he was going to go on and win, you know, three or four. It hasn't happened. He doesn't like playing at the Crucible, funny enough. You know, he thinks it's a little bit sort of cramped in there. He's always sort of giving out. He's quite a tall lad. It can be a little bit tight around when the screen is down or you know, when you're playing on next to the boarding around the table. But, yeah, he doesn't like playing there. You know, he's won it once and he hasn't really performed as the way he did, and that's a long time ago. So, yeah, he's got to overcome those sort of obstacles. And but, yeah, I expected him to win a few, but it just hasn't happened for him. It'd be interesting to see what sort of, you know, form he's going to find here at the World Championship. If he does find form, well, then that would be fantastic for the tournament. There's no doubt about that. And a semi-final against the possibility of Mark Selby, if he comes through, of course, is a tough match. Because I think himself and Alan in the quarterfinal, that would be a real test for him.
I think another lefty that a lot of people love watching is the Welshman Mark Williams, and he definitely is a fan favourite. And you look at the draw he's got as well. He's got Jimmy Robertson in the opening round, and then a possible second round tie against Luca Brasel or Ricky Walden. There could be a quarter final there for against Ronnie O'Sullivan as well.
Like, I think you're right. I think he'll come. I think Williams, you know, is a great outsider. I think you might get him at about 40-1 or something like that. But himself, Williams and Higgins, both around the same, and both sort of, you know, very experienced players. You know, Higgins has won it four times. Williams is three times. And both very, very dangerous. And they could be good outsiders. But, yeah, I think Williams will come through that. He should face Ding Junhui, Hussein Bafay, or Ronnie O'Sullivan in the quarterfinals. I'm presuming it will be Ronnie. And I think he'll put it up to Ronnie. There's no doubt about that.
I was looking at last year's opening draw there last night, Ken, and noticed, I think it was three of the 16 ties went the way of the qualifier. So it doesn't happen too often, but there's always those few shocks you'd imagine in the opening round. Can you see any? Yeah. We haven't mentioned Judd Trump. He's against Anthony McGill, a man who just loves the Crucible. Like, there could be potential qualifier shocks in the opening round.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I'm looking at that. Judd Trump, that's a horrible draw for Judd Trump. Anthony McGill in the first round, he got to the semi-finals. 1 year, lost 17-16 to Corin Wilson in the semi. It's one of the most dramatic semi-finals we've ever seen. Yeah, Trump hasn't played well since the Masters, really. And that was back in January. So that's really a potential banana skin for him in the first round. He won't like playing McGill. McGill will love it. And that could be a possible win for McGill there. And Jack Lazowski, you know, one player that I love watching. I mean, he's so talented, but he's never got his hands on a trophy, a ranking time. Yeah, he's been beaten in six finals. He's a wonderful talent, and I'd love to see him play well. But he's playing Nopon Sangham in the first round from Thailand, and that's another potential banana skin.
Absolutely. Well, we'll keep an eye on it. You'll be busy with the media over the next few weeks, Ken, no doubt.
Yeah, looking forward to it. All the boys will be arriving today and starts again, as you said. Ronnie O'Sullivan starts out his campaign tomorrow at 10 a.m. But yeah, really, really looking forward to it. It's so exciting. I mean, you know what it's like at Sheffield over the 17 days. People coming from all over the world to watch the World Championships. Over 45,000, you know, tickets over the 17 days. Sold, completely sold out from last year. And it's just exciting. It's just such a wonderful buzz in the city, and it's fantastic. I just love it, you know.
We've got a message in here from someone who wants to thank you as well. Greg London says, "Top man, Ken, passed my college exams in 97 following the Worlds, turned down the volume and kept me inside for the whole tournament." So,
oh, right. Oh, well, that's nice. At least he passed it anyway.
Yeah, all these years later, still remembers. Ken, great stuff as always. Listen, enjoy the crucible, and we'll no doubt catch up during the tournament at some point as well.
I'll see you. It's over here, Shane. Yeah, okay. Enjoy.
We'll grab a pint. Cheers, Ken. Good man.
Cheers, guys.
Ken Doherty, always an absolute legend. So, how much of this? Because there's a lot of it.
Yeah, 17 days long, but it's brilliant. It's one of those sports that even people who aren't snooker fans necessarily, it's like the darts for the 17 days they tune in or doze off in front of the TV when the snooker's on. Mm. You can just it's not a viewing intense. It's not a viewing
intense. You're
really
selling it to us there, Jay.
No, but like then you wake up when the claps start happening and it's like, oh, I better watch the rest of this.
4 hours later and the game is like barely moved on.
It's ASMR. That's what I've described it as before. Auto sensory meridian response. You get the sound of the balls going into the pocket and all the rest. It's a wonderful sport.
When are you heading over?
Heading over this day week. So I'll get the Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday in.
Oh, okay. So what sort of what stage is that at?
It'll be kind of the full second round and hopefully the first day or two of the quarterfinals.
Are you going back later on in the tournament or no?
I was thinking about it. I don't know.
It's an unusual.
I know. You see, sometimes I've gone twice before and I've never seen Ronnie yet playing there because the two times I've gone were the two times I mentioned he was knocked out in the first round and the second round. So I was like, right, round. Let's sneak that in this time.
Yeah, okay.
So maybe I'll go back for a second.
Are you working or are you just over?
I'm gonna enjoy it Saturday and Sunday and work Monday, Tuesday.
All right.
And get a few interviews and that sort of bit.
Getting paid to go over and sort of going over to half enjoy yourself. It's great come from here, Shane. It's
fantastic, isn't it?
Right, do keep the comments coming into us as well. And a reminder, by the way, if you want more great GA chat, the football pod are hitting the road again. They're off to Killarney this time. It'll be Off the Ball's first big show of the summer. All with thanks to AIB. Tommy, Paddy, James are going to be bringing the football pod to the Great Southern Hotel. It's a live episode, a live recording, and a special guest as well on the night to be announced. It'll be Thursday, the 4th of May, so it's not that far away. You can join us for a brilliant night of football, crack and chat. Plenty of focus on the All-Ireland Champions Kerry course as well, and the contenders who will come in for their crown, and an exclusive off-air event. Tickets are limited, and don't delay. So you can go to offtheball.com/events for that. And I know that we're going very quickly over the first couple of days, so if you if they're still available, get up there and get your hands on some ticket goodness, all in partnership with AIB. Check out #thetoughest for more on all of that. But right now it's time at gone 10 to 9 to turn our attention back to the rugby. Delighted to say we're joined on the line again by former Ireland international Anna Caplice. Morning, Anna.
Well, lads, how are you?
How are you getting on?
Good now. More sport this morning, is it?
There's a fair bit of sport, yeah. That's the common theme on this. Sometimes we squeeze in some other stuff, but generally there's a lot going on.
I'm thinking of changing sport. I think I'll become a snooker fan.
Ah, go for it, Anna.
Well, I mean, Shane's recommendation there, Anna, that you know you can have a doze off in the middle of it was definitely appealing to me. That was.
I know. I was just listening to it there, like, especially all the drama and women's rugby. I think I need something a bit more calming.
Well, you've segued beautifully into the first thing that we need to ask you about. We will come to talk about the game because there's plenty to get into, and we will do that. Ireland, Italy, of course. But first of all, the Telegraph article. We'd spoken to you a couple of weeks ago, and you touched on the reasons behind your own decisions to walk away, and it felt like actually looking at some of the stuff that had come through in the article was reminded me of what you were talking about. And obviously we had the Ireland head coach Greg McWilliams out in the meantime to reflect on that. We'd Fiona Hayes on the Six Nations show yesterday, Anna, and she was saying that she was only surprised by the fact that people were surprised by the stuff that came out, that it wasn't necessarily new news.
Absolutely. Yeah, I was reading it like, you know, pretending to be shocked kind of a thing, because, yeah, none of it's new to me. None of it's new to anyone who's been involved in women's rugby for quite some time will have experienced things like this kind of, an alarming amount of sexism And then I read through it and I was like, you know, that's, it's kind of, there's definitely more to it. And I always say, like, the story of Irish women's rugby is like a big, massive jigsaw, and everyone has a piece that they could contribute to it. And, you know, every player will have their own story. And sadly, a lot of it is stories of, like, frustration and disappointment. And so, you know, this you know, Telegraph article wasn't news to me. And I think I agree with Fihaz. They're saying, like, she was surprised that people were surprised. I think people are surprised less and less, to be honest. Mm. And I think the overwhelming response, it's in a way, it's nice to see. Is there some kind of comfort to be taken in the fact that people are like, we've had enough of this? Like, often before, and certainly in the past few years, if something like this would come out, it's, you know, people kind of get back to it saying and respond saying, like, ah, the women giving out again. Those responses are becoming less and less because people are like, what's something else. What, we need to sort this out. We need to support the girls. And we need, and I feel like there's so much support for the girls now, and people really understand that the girls and these results are not reflective of the squad and the ability of the squad. It's their support that comes in. I think that's kind of becoming very clear to, like, fans of the game and followers of rugby in general and sport in general in Ireland now, because we want this team to succeed. Yet here we are again talking about more sexism and, like, you know, the shorts and the contracts and all that. Like, when can we actually talk about the rugby? We have to just, like, I'm not saying that we shouldn't talk about this. We have to talk about this. When are we going to get to a stage when we can talk about this less and less and talk about the actual performances more and more, where we are in contention to win a Six Nations?
Yeah, like, it is a very good point. And as you say, we have to talk about it. And I know you're not suggesting we don't talk about it, because it's important that when it comes up now, and the fact that it's come up as an international story as well, I think it's important. And almost that point, Anne, it feels like we need to be hearing from players like yourself who've been recently in the system, or players who are currently in the system, like, at the minute we have an absence of people who fit that profile, who are coming out to say everything here is brilliant, we've learned all the lessons from the past, and this has been fixed and this has been fixed and the communication is good. It feels like we're missing that piece at the minute.
I've been trying to think of, I agree with you, and I've been trying to think of an analogy to kind of explain this really in non-rugby terms, or see how else this could be related to, do you know, how these processes happen in life. So, for example, like, I used to be a teacher in England, and all the schools get graded from outstanding is your top level, good requires improvement, and failing or whatever. And if you are a failing school and you make an overhaul and you appoint new staff and you bring in, they're not going to say, like, they don't just say, okay, great, we've made these changes, now off you go. No, you get a review every month. Everything is reviewed. There's, like, an overhaul of, you know, staff, systems, everything. So, like, in the recently, you know, with the appointment of, like, new staff, we can't just be like, right, we'll leave you off now, we trust you to do it all. No, this is a requires improvement / failing situation. Mm. We're not going to just sit back and be like, okay, you know, that's fine. If we're losing, it's fine, because we trust what's going on. Maybe they are doing the right thing and we don't see it yet. I'm skeptical, and I've said that before. I'm skeptical and I'm cynical because of what I've been through as a player. So I'm just not going to sit here and be like, okay, we'll take your word for it. You know, when someone turns around and says, no, everything's fine, I can't take your word from it. And you're right, there are players like me who've come out recently and that are standing up, because we know that current players can't. I know that from myself. Like, I could never say what I really wanted to. I'm trying to do that now as best I can, while still, you know, keeping, like, my friends, like the players who are still in the squad, and the girls that I don't know, keeping them in my thoughts all the time by the things that I say and how I go about how I say things. And everyone is like that. The thing here is, we all want the same thing. We all want Irish women's rugby to start performing. And I think the IRFU has done a good job in making it seem like we're against each other somehow, the former players against the current players, against the management, against the sevens, against the 15s or whatever. I don't know. I just think that we all have to remember that we all want the same thing here, and that is to improve and compete and like get to the same level of rugby that our men's team is at and our under 20s team is at, and like have fair chances at really performing and competing.
Obviously, the IRFU came out in response to Fiona Thomas's article to say, well, we've put these structures in place, and that's fair enough. Obviously, like you say, in terms of a union or an association or any governing body where it's been identified that there's stuff that needs to be improved, and I think demonstrably there is stuff that's been improved, and there's obviously more work to be done in that regard, and they will defend themselves in relation to that. Greg McWilliams obviously was out to put forward to do that yesterday as well. Can you just talk to us, Anna, about your own experience, if you can, just in relation to the stuff that you read in relation to, you know, you mentioned about the shorts. Obviously, you spoke to us before about the communication of team selections. What can you tell us about your own experience of the pieces that you read in that article?
Yeah, I think that's squad selection kind of issue. That affected me a lot as a player. I was in the receiving end of that. Lots of girls were in terms of being forgotten to be told that you were dropped, or forgotten to be, you know, told in advance of a meeting, and suddenly you look at the screen and your name's not there. That's hard to talk about, because that's the management themselves. How they managed that was they managed it badly, depending on, you know, what coaches were involved at the time. There was always mistakes around this. But I think that...
Can I ask you, Anna, sorry to interrupt. I just ask you on that? Because some of what's been said here from Greg McWilliams was that this is... Why is this article coming out now? This is historic stuff. Can you give us a timeline on what you're talking about?
I mean... And I can only speak of my experiences, even though whoever was interviewed for this has a similar story, you know, but I'll only speak for myself.
Yeah.
I left the squad in, it was the previous management. Oh my God, I can't keep track of the years now. 2022 is when I was dropped from the squad for the last time, and then I decided to take myself out of to retire. But that, you know, that's only, you know, a couple of months before that, or a year before that. You know, if he's saying it's historic, I don't agree with that statement.
And do you have a sense from what you're hearing or what you've experienced of whether things have improved since then?
I'm obviously not in the squad, so from the outside looking in, I feel like no. And that, you know, to say that it's historic, I don't think, like, what does historic mean? When does that come into effect? Like, if you still have players that are suffering from those, you know, the trauma of something like that happening before, that's not historic. That's still current. You still have to deal with that within the current members of the squad, if there are current members of the squad who still, you know, have a fear that that could happen, or it's happened to them before. Like, even though it might not have been you as a coach, you still have to value that in your player's experience. And you know, and I think the reason that these errors keep happening is from the top down, there's no fear for them that they're going to be reprimanded for making an error like this, or that there's like a worry. It was just, you know, pure casual, like, oh, sorry about that, when actually your whole world has fallen apart in a moment, and like, whoops, on their behalf, because there's no real consequence for them to have, you know, to have just missed you off a list, or forgot to text, or forgot to call. Like, that's massive, you know, the difference in experience for them, which is like, whoops, versus, oh my God, you know, everything I've worked for here hasn't worked out for me. Like, that, the difference in that is massive, and it's a recurring trend. Whether it's happening in the current squad, from the article, it tells us that it is. So, I don't know what else to add.
And it's even the lack of something small, like the lack of protein supplements available to players for the Tour of Japan last summer, and even the derogatory comment about the alleged derogatory comment about women's rugby at the president's dinner as well. Like, did the likes of that comment surprise you, Anna?
Absolutely not. I'm here laughing because I've heard that comment a million times. Like, I hear it all the time. I still hear it from, you know, people in rugby, supporters, fans. I have people writing to me privately to tell me that no one gives an F about women's rugby. You see it, you can see it, you can read it. Like, and you know, these might be fans, but people in positions of power that, you know, that also doesn't surprise me. I know, like, someone I know that she was telling me about a committee meeting she had attended. And this also isn't new. And if you're a club that doesn't behave this way, I'm not referring to you, but if you're a club that behaves this way, I am referring to you. There are, like, you know, the contents of the meeting. So they'll go through, like, starting with senior men, senior seconds, senior thirds, under 20s, under 18s, under 15s, under 13s, under 10s, minis. Right, is that everything covered? And, you know, the women have to say, excuse me, what about the women? Referring to everything after you've talked about the minis section. That's not strange. And if you're a club who's changed that and you go from men's senior team to women's senior team to under 20s, good, well done. Like, or even starting with the women's agenda, like, depending on, like, what stage of the season you're at or whatever. But it's not, that's not unusual to have the women's matters dealt with as people are getting up out of their chairs in a club. And these are the people who go on to, you know, work in, you know, get senior roles in the provinces and the union or whatever. That's not unusual.
I don't want you to feel badgered by these questions, and we will move on to talk about the rugby in a minute, but I do think that it was important that we chat about it. When you say there's people writing to you, Anna, what do you mean?
Just, I don't even know, like, they're... I'd like to say that they're trolls, but some of them I can see, like, what club they're connected to, or their fans or their players or whatever, and they'll, you know, write to me saying, like, it only happened recently. I had a really bad week there recently because I put out something. It was in response to the Tiger Woods thing, and I sent a tweet, and the amount of abuse that I got from rugby fans, and I can see that they're rugby fans. You know, and they'll say in their profile, follower of whatever province, whatever club, and they'll be a social. I can see that these people exist within clubs that have no time to listen to, like, women's players or athletes or whatever, and women's sport and whatever for them is just, like, not just irrelevant, an actual problem for them. For them to go out of their way and write to me. And I took it down off my Twitter in the end because I'd had such a bad week of receiving stuff like this. And then people went and found me on my other social media platforms and wrote to me, even though I hadn't, like, put anything there. So, you know, it's easy to find someone in rugby, like someone like me, who a former player who's, you know, active on social media. It's easy to find me and write to me and tell me what you really think. That's what I was referring to there.
Okay. It's a level of bonkers, I think, that is, and I also think that there's an element of, we tend to talk about this stuff of it being faceless social media, and certainly some of the stuff that we've seen here over the last few weeks in relation to various bits, the facelessness of it is the fact that it is actual. You can easily identify who people are is the thing that's starting to that I definitely caught me a bit by surprise and was unusual. The one, just to leave it on this and move on to talk about the game, but the thing that sort of struck me about it is that, like, it's hard for people to hear stuff that's not good, that doesn't reflect well on them, right? Like, that's just a human trait. Somebody says, this thing you need to work on, your initial reaction can be defensive. So whether you're an individual or an organisation, that can be the case. And that was the one area of disappointment that I had over the last 48 hours, that there wasn't an element of officialdom in Irish rugby saying, okay, we thought we were sort of a little bit down the line. It's kind of clear that we're not, and there's a bit more work to be done. Will you just can we take that away? Can we think about it? Can we come back with some sort of a thought through response? That just bit seemed to be lacking.
I completely agree. And I'm just wondering, who is it going to take? Who is going to be the person to say that? Yes, you're right. And I have to comment on the comments from Greg. Like, you know, for him to say, no, this isn't a sexist organization. Why can't you just, you know, not just you as in terms of Greg, why can't someone just say, yes, we're dealing with this, we're going to do everything we can to make sure that we can eradicate this title and this behaviors and you know, to flat out just stand up and say, no, I don't think so. I was really annoyed at that. And, you know, stand up for your girls, stand up for the players. Who's going to stand up for the players? Who's going to say, yes, we understand this. We're doing everything we can to change this. Instead of saying, no, it doesn't exist. Stand up for the girls. Like, please, someone, who's it going to be to say, yes, we recognize this? Because every time that there's been someone to stand up and put out a story like this or an article, you're absolutely right. They've acted in a defensive way and said, no, this isn't the case. Even in that article, it was like, oh, we can't comment on this because we don't know who the player is. Well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who it is or isn't. Like, let's say, okay, an error. We made an error. We acknowledge it. We recognize it. We want to move on. But up till now, like, and there was a few other things in that article that really struck me. Like, you know, that Greg and David Nusafora sat down to make a plan. And that they're on track with the plan. How could you be on track with the plan? Was the plan to come last in the Six Nations? Because that's what we're on track for now. Mm. Is that the plan? Was that really the plan? And these are the comments that make me feel like we're undervalued. You know, there were so many things like, you know, the historic, it's not historic. It's not nearly irrelevant. We're not on track. Like, these are all, like, if we could just see, you know, stop the defensive attitude and say, no, this is all perfect. It's not perfect. Please acknowledge that. And please, like, let's say that this is where we're at. We are doing everything. Because I know there are some brilliant people in the IRFU. And if this is how difficult it seems from the outside, I can imagine it's very difficult for people on the inside to also achieve things. But let's recognize it and move on together. Because at the end of the day, we all want the same thing here. We're not on different teams. We're all on the same team. We all want the same thing. Let's work together. Stop pipping us against each other. It's not, you know, like I already said, you know, the groups against each other. That's not what this is. We need to move forward together.
I presume if one of those people in the IRFU was to pick up the phone later on today over the next couple of weeks and say, Anna, you've been through this over the last while, you've been vocal about it, can we grab a coffee and chat through your experiences of it? That's something you're open to.
Absolutely. But I don't... absolutely, 100%. That's what I promised myself when I retired, that I would contribute to this journey as best I could. No one in the IRFU ever spoke to me again after Greg McWilliams called me the day to tell me I wasn't going to be in the squad. No one ever spoke to me ever again. So I don't foresee it.
I'd say away from the constraints of a live broadcast, that would be probably a smart thing for the IRFU to do. We'll see how that plays out over the next while. Thanks for giving, Anna. I know it's a hard one for you to get into, so appreciate it. Let's talk about the rugby. Obviously, a couple of heavy defeats. A pivotal game now against Italy, England, Scotland come after that. Is there without going back into the conversation we've just had, in terms of the playing side of it, is there like a renewed, is there a different target for this group now, Anna? Has the success measures changed for them given what's happened over the first couple of games?
I think so. I think that it's funny, you know, and after the result of the French game, and there was a lot of, you know, kind of negative critique and everything, which was, you know, warranted with the scoreline against a 14-woman French side. So for me watching that, I took away loads of positives. I was like, that was great. This moment was great. That moment was great. So I can imagine, like, within the squad, they are feeling like, look at that moment. Look at what we achieved there. And let's build on those moments, because there were some brilliant, like some set piece, massive wins, like stealing the lineouts and scrum wins and stuff, like against France. And I think that they'll feel that if they can continue with those like moments, like, you know, small wins to transfer them into like bigger wins, they'll be happy. So I think, yeah, they know where they're at now. I think the kind of interesting thing about this is that Italy are scared of Ireland. And I think that Italy is like another world of rugby that will have very little idea of the media coverage that Ireland has been getting. They'll obviously see the scorelines and they'll have done their homework on Ireland. But in terms of all this extra conversation around Ireland that the Welsh women and the English girls and the Scottish girls are very aware of, Italy isn't aware of that. They don't know about all these extra stories. They don't kind of seem to be, you know, in a separate little rugby world over there. And that's fine for them. But I do think they have a fear. I think they have a fear of Ireland. So I think for Ireland coming into this game, this will be key, like a key performance and a place to pick up points.
The two sort of pivotal areas watching the our own Six Nations show yesterday seemed to be identified as our own unstructured attack, which might be a function of being constantly on the back foot, of course, and then Italy, the ferociousness at which they went at the breakdown against France. Mm-hmm. Two areas that potentially decide the outcome of this.
Absolutely. And I think that, well, Italy are, they're similar to their men's team. They're kind of put together like a couple of like amazing phases and just can't seem to finish things off. Now they've picked up some great experience at the World Cup and they had some real standout players. So that will obviously like start to change. They had a very tough two opening rounds, you know, so will be very battle hardened from England and France. And their physicality will be massive. But, you know, Ireland have just played France as well. So it'll be a similar level they'll meet at in the middle at the breakdown. And, you know, if Ireland can kind of sort out their nomination in defence and communication defence to, like, nail those, like, missed tackles, that'll be huge for them. Like, and no doubt that they'll have worked on that. Like, any player who missed a tackle the last day is going to be like, I ain't missing a tackle on Saturday here in Parma. Like, that's, so if that can, that small detail can be rectified, then that will change the flow of things.
And are we going to finally get a W on the board?
I always want to say yes, because when you're a player, and which is only, you know, recently for me, you believe that you will. And, you know, the last time in Parma for the Irish team wasn't, they're not good memories, but we did beat Italy. And when you're going into this match with all you've learned from the first two games and the whole world on fire outside of your squad, all you're talking about is how do we get the win here? Because absolutely they believe they can. So yeah, I'm going to back them and I'm going to say that yeah, we can.
Okay. Good. Well, there's plenty in our chat over the last 20 minutes. And as I said a little bit earlier, we appreciate you being open and honest about that stuff. It's, I think, important for now that we have those conversations. And yeah, as you say, let's hope again in 6 months or whatever length of time it takes that we're in a position where we can just talk about the rugby. We'd be delighted to do that. But for the minute, Anna, thanks a million.
Thanks, lads.
Anna Caplice on the line there, looking ahead to the weekend's rugby and reacting as well to what's going on with Irish rugby during the week. Now, where are we off to? Are we going to take an ad break? Or we are. Thanks, Anna. It's 9:15. We're going to talk about Noz Choudry's new book, Inshallah United, after these.
To OTB AM. OTB GAA.
It had never been done before, so my whole thing was, just because it hasn't been done before, it doesn't mean that it can't be done now. So I was very strong-willed, and I was very lucky to get some excellent coaching in Vincent's, and that really gave me the platform to put a map in place of how I could actually do it.
Subscribe to the OTB GAA podcast feed wherever you get your podcasts.
Is there players that are eligible and at that level? Do we know, Grace, is there players out there, or what the case is? Well, look, what I think on that is, first of all, for me, Cliona Maloney definitely is someone that probably should be involved in the squad. She's playing well in England if you're looking at her form and you're looking at her caps and you're just looking at her presence. The reason she's not there, we don't know. It's been said form, I would probably question that. So when I'm looking at that, it's Cliona who is clear front runner. I'm coaching, I'm playing IL. There's no one being left out of the squad that has absolutely rocked the AIL or the Interpros that isn't there. And that's the honest truth from my side of things. I've watched every game all season, either back on Huddle or I've watched the Interpros I was involved in that. So I think the players that were picked is the coach's choice. I'm not saying people should or shouldn't be there, but there's no one really overlooked massively other than Cliona.
OTB AM with Gillette Labs. Get the ultimate shave or your money back. Neon Night Edition available now.
20 past 9, you're watching OTB AM and we are live with Gillette Labs. Get the ultimate shave or your money back. Neon Night Edition is available now. And by the way, you would have heard just there in the ads that it was Grace Davitt and Fiona Hayes joined Aisling at the Six Nations Show discussing the notable omissions from the Ireland squad and the Six Nations shows with Vodafone, main sponsor of the Irish rugby team. We all belong to the team of us. Do keep the comments coming in, by the way. We're with you until 10 this morning. And also a reminder, by the way, that we're going to be hosting a live UEFA Champions League roadshow, all in partnership with Just Eat. It's coming your way on the 3rd of May. It's in the Mansion House in Dublin. There'll be UEFA Champions League winners John O'Shea, Wes Brown and the Arsenal legend Paul Merson. And it's sure to be a brilliant night's entertainment, an exclusive off-air event, tickets limited, so don't delay. Go to offtheball.com/events now and we'll see you on the night. Just Eat, the official food delivery partner of the UEFA Champions League. So that's where we'll leave that right now. We've been promising this one for, I think, about 3 or 4 weeks. I'm delighted to say he's in danger now of becoming a friend of the show, but delighted to welcome back to the show, Noz Choudry. Noz, how are you doing?
Yeah, good. How are you doing?
Very good. We plan to talk to you about United, but we've no time for any of that messing around. We want to give all the time we have to the book, which I've been listening to the audiobook over the last couple of weeks and thoroughly enjoying it. And I wondered, was it a book that you had been writing in your head over the years, or was it a more of a latter day, I must do this?
Well, it's interesting because there was like, do you know, like with transfers, you always get teams having to woo a player or sort of convince them to sort of join or whatever. Like it was a little bit like that, where the publishers approached me and kind of said, do you want to write this book? And then there was like a six month period where I was like saying, I don't know about this. Like there's nothing interesting about me. No one wants to read about me. So it took a bit of convincing for me to actually write the book, because I think as with most people, if somebody asked you to write a book about yourself, you'd be like, well, what's happened? I've not sort of saved a kid from drowning, or I've not sort of escaped to like a war torn situation. I've just grown up in Crumpsall. So I'm glad that I was convinced to do it. It's really just something that came about because I was asked to do it, and then it was just a case of like how I go about it and how much football I put in it, how much of myself I put in it.
Yeah. It's always a hard balance to get right. And was there a point where in that 6 months, or once you started writing the book, where you thought, oh no, actually, there is something there. I do have a story to tell.
Yeah, I mean, I think what I decided pretty early on is that there's no point in doing a history of United over that sort of late 80s and the whole of the 90s period, just because it's done before. Like if anyone wants to know what happened during that period, there's loads better writers than me that can go into lots of detail about individual games and individual results. So I decided that the best way to do it was to be dead personal. So a lot of it, I mean, I obviously a lot of it is to do with football, but it's about how football impacted my life rather than going through every single result. So a lot of it's just about, and again, like my parents came over from Pakistan, so they didn't have a club. So I didn't inherit a club. So a lot of it's about finding football, getting passionate about football, growing up in Manchester. So you couldn't escape it really. But also stuff like getting into like Manchester music, getting into Manchester fashion, all that kind of stuff.
I loved how it could have been Harlequins Inshallah, I presume is going to ring a bell for you. Or like it could have easily have been City Inshallah either.
But that's it. Again, it's but I think this is with everyone, but especially with communities from a diaspora community, whether it's sort of people from Pakistan or people from sort of the West Indies or Ireland or anywhere, is that your parents decide where to settle, but you don't. You're just born there. So my family could easily have settled in Brixton or Liverpool or Newcastle or even Toronto or somewhere abroad. So it's they happened to settle in Manchester, and then it was a case of thankfully it wasn't Harley Quinn, so it was and I could be saved from salmon trousers, and it was more a case of like, is it City or United?
But it's funny because that decision of which football team to choose to support, or any sporting team to choose to support, sometimes it's not a decision, sometimes it's passed on by a parent or whatever. But You touch on the book, two of your mates when you were a kid, Terence and Thomas, and there's a great line from the book. He said, everything else being equal, it should have been City, as Adrian said. Terence was a better mate, plus he had Panini spares of the likes of Jason Beckford and Andy Dibble to sweeten the deal. You went with Thomas, though, in the end. Why was that?
It was purely because the thing is, Terence was a closer mate, but Thomas was just obsessed. I think that's always incredibly sort of attractive in anything where somebody is so passionate about something that you can't help but be interested as well. And it's a little bit like I'll meet somebody who's mad about rugby or mad about anything, and suddenly that thing takes on more importance just because they care about it so much. It's just the fact that my mate Thomas was just obsessed with United, and that attracted me more than anything. And the funny thing is that obviously United have always been like historically the bigger club, but at that time I think both clubs were kind of struggling, and it was just unfortunate that because City were in the second tier at that point, and they'd got promoted, so there'd been a few years where I'd got into football and did not been a derby. But then in 89 there was the 5-1, and I thought, oh no, I've made the wrong decision.
It's very much definitely, and particularly in the latter day, in light of how good City have got recently. You mentioned a bit earlier on, just obviously about it not, I can't remember actually, did you say it was not quite a football book, or there's not a huge amount about the football bit in it? Like, it does feel as if it's a book about like belonging or like being part of something almost kind of bigger than yourself, and you speak about the challenges of the come for a kid of a first generation immigrant family. Has your experience, because like these are themes that are, like, it was really interesting to read, in my case, listen to your experiences of, I don't want to put an age on you, but like 30 odd years ago, and what it was like growing up around football at that time. And I just was interested to get your view on the difference of that time versus now, and whether like football / society has moved on to be a more inclusive environment for people of all backgrounds or no.
Well, it's funny because when I was growing up, things weren't great. There was lots of racism. There was lots of, funnily enough, there was more racism about people like me being Pakistani rather than being Muslim, whereas it's kind of flipped the other way around now. But throughout the time I was growing up, and as bad as it was, especially in the 80s and then in the 90s, there was always a sense that over time things will get better. And you kind of saw that, and you thought people are going to get more sort of welcoming of different people. People are going to mingle, have communities where there's all sorts of sort of multicultural influences, and year by year, people will become more accepting of everyone. And that's certainly how it felt. But then There's that kind of heartbreaking realization that you get where you kind of think, actually, life's not like that. It's not an incline of things getting better. What it is cyclical. So you will have situations where you feel as if people are being accepted more, and racism and prejudice and xenophobia and prejudices against like the LGBTQ plus community and things like that, that's going to get better. But then there's a whole new wave of hatred, and that's one of the sad things. It's not quite included in the book because the book sort of ends in 1999 for obvious reasons. But then a few years later, there's 9/11, and all the sort of fallout of that, and yeah, and it's and then you've got the rise of right wing politics around the world. So it's a little bit of a bittersweet thing that where you kind of expect that things are going to get better, and then you realize life's not always like that.
No, it's certainly not. And yet you have this intricate, beautiful way of describing the football match day experience with your faith as well, the communal nature of going to a match, even as early as the prologue you're talking about, and it's great advice as well. If anyone's ever going to a match, take out the AirPods, get out, a stop earlier on the tram. There's that sense of belonging. It's almost, even for people watching or listening who aren't religious, it almost is a religious experience for people heading to a match.
Completely, and again, it's in one sense, it's very easy to sort of crowbar that analogy and sort of try and bring this artificial sort of comparison between football and religion together. But there are similarities, and whether it's going to a pub, or whether it's having a community sort of social club, or whether it's a church or a mosque, I think a big part of that is doing something together. You have your internal beliefs, and you have your sort of internal sort of morality, but then beyond that, what makes religion or anything like that special is you are part of something. You all have a core belief. And you may be different in loads of ways, but you have this one thing that you have in common. And in a lot of ways, that is mirrored by football in a different way, in that growing up, I had so many different identities that I was coming to terms with, especially as a teenager. I think everyone has. Everyone is finding the way. Everyone's rebelling against the parents. Everyone's trying to be an individual. Everyone's trying to find their tribe. And being Pakistani, Muslim, working class, Mancunian, there's loads of different things that you come to terms with, and some things you're more proud of than others, and then you grow to be proud of everything. But the great thing about football is you identify yourself as a fan, and suddenly you're welcomed in, and it doesn't matter who you are or what your background is, you've all got that one thing in common, and that's all that matters, and people will have your back, people will befriend you and talk to you in a way that doesn't always happen in other parts of life. And that's the great thing about things like music. And it's a great thing about things like sport and football, in that it breaks down all sorts of barriers. And suddenly you find yourself becoming friends with people that you in any other situation you'd never meet, and you probably wouldn't talk to. And that's a beautiful thing about football, and that's why it means so much, because it shouldn't matter. It shouldn't matter this much. Like even like all the sports that you've discussed on your show today or every day you record, none of it should matter. It's sport. It's people running about. Like why are people so obsessed with it? And the reason why people are obsessed is because A, it's something you can share with other people around the world and in your community, but also it's that thing of you work your life, you work 5 days a week, or you do this job or that, and then once or twice a week you forget about all of that, and you can escape into this thing that sometimes can break your heart, but sometimes can be amazing. But it's this thing that you all do together.
That's an incredible point, that one about like seeking out things that actually that we have in common, which is just like not what we tend to do as societies. Like there's I was struck by your comments earlier on, there's a hashtag on the rise here, unfortunately, which is Ireland is full. You can imagine I wouldn't recommend you look it up anytime soon, but you can imagine the ideas that are behind that. Trying to create points of difference with people, because it feels like the and I was going to say early, but maybe not all that early, bubbling up of Brexit style philosophies and thought processes, did it feel like that was a pivotal moment, Noz, for you, in terms of that sort of, like, it feels like that sort of flushed people out of the middle ground almost? You had to kind of either I'm for inclusiveness, or I'm part of those horrible hashtag movements.
Yeah, well, I mean, you talk about sort of writing the book, and I was talking about how I thought that no one would be interested in this book, and therefore why write it, because I didn't want to do something just for the sake of it. But once I started to think about it, and once I started to think about the kind of book that I wanted to write, one thing that was really important to me was to show people that I am an Asian person. I am of Pakistani heritage, and I am proudly Muslim. I'm not just culturally Muslim. I'm a practicing Muslim. But if you read the book, hopefully you'll realize that I'm just like you. Like there's so many similarities in the way we enjoy life, the way some things happen in our lives, like the book covers the deaths of loved ones. It covers sort of euphoric things and sad things, but there's so many similarities between us. And you talk about that hashtag, and you talk about all the rampant prejudice that goes on in the UK as well, especially fueled by the right-wing press. And I guarantee that all these people who are saying certain places are full or they don't want these people to come here, they have not met those people. That's why if you look at the demographic, or if you look at a map of places that voted Brexit or sort of places with certain prejudice or bigoted political views, it's always places that don't have that multiculturalism, and it's always those places that are away from the city centres, the inner city areas, where people have met people of different backgrounds, have gone to school with them, go to work with them, and realise that there's no difference between you. Mm. And if there's one thing I'd love for the book to achieve, it's for somebody who's maybe not met a Muslim or not met somebody from a Pakistani background to read it, and it just gives them a different view of what a Muslim or a Pakistani person is compared to what they will read in like the Daily Mail or whatever.
I think there's an Irish songwriter and singer and poet called Imelda May, who, like, in relation to Ireland specifically, says we don't get the right to be racist for historic reasons of emigration. And I mean, I think that that definitely sums it up. Not that anybody in that hashtag is going to be too interested in what Imelda May has to say, of course, but that's unfortunate what you're dealing with. This book is lots of fun. It's I listened to the audiobook. There was loads of laugh out loud moments. You love a good list, now, as it turns out, as we do around here. A nice top five. Your top five players from the 90s. This plays well with an Irish audience.
Yeah.
With a Cork audience, I should say.
I was going to say particularly a Cork audience. Yes. I mean, it had to be. I mean, obviously, I had to include Roy Keane, but then Dennis Irwin, what a player. I actually, everyone talks about, because there's certain players who are so underrated, and everyone talks about them being underrated, that in a funny way they become overrated because everyone's talking about them being underrated. But I still believe that Dennis Irwin is incredibly underrated to this day. Like, I think there's an assumption with people who've not seen him play that he was incredibly dependable and a 7 out of 10 player every week, and that's what made him so great. And it's not. He was a 9 out of 10 player every week. He could do everything. He could play both fullback positions with ease. He was two-footed. These days you've got players who play fullback that are either very good defensively and poor going forward, or the opposite, are amazing going forward but then defensively weak. It would be difficult to identify what he was better at. Mm. And I had to include him. But then obviously Keno, he had to be in there, but I think my number one choice won't be a surprise to anyone, especially in that era.
And it's even the cult heroes as well. Noz, like you mentioned, Andrei Kanchelskis, and you're talking about laugh out loud moments. One of the lines you had, he, a precociously talented footballer from the USSR, me, an asthmatic little Asian kid with a stutter and a dream, a Cold War thawing foreign exchange program that only one of us was aware of. Like, and he's one of those players as well, Kanchelskis, that. Is probably under the term cult hero, but to remember players like that just bring you straight back in the blink of thought to your childhood must be nice.
Oh yeah, I mean there was tough times writing the book, because it's almost a weird kind of therapy to sort of go back to your childhood and remember stuff that you'd forgotten about. But there was great moments as well, and it would seem weird to some people that the thing is, like, apart from Cantona and Kanchelskis, I don't think I really devote that much time to individual players. And so it might seem a little bit strange, of all the star players that we had during that period, I kind of zoned in on Kanchelskis as one of them. But again, it's about how it made you feel at the time. It's not me as an adult retrospectively looking back and thinking, oh, that was a really important player, that was a really important game. If that was the case, then I'd be focusing on United winning the doubles, but and certain other important trophies. But to me, growing up, the European Cup Winners' Cup win in 1991 was seminal, and Andrei Kanchelskis was just magic to me. I look back far more fondly on Andrei Kanchelskis than I do Cristiano Ronaldo. And even if you take away any kind of controversy, I still would, because football ultimately is how it makes you feel. It's not about who's got the best stats. It's not about who's got the best XG or who's won the most trophies. It's the players that gave you those special sort of moments and those emotions at the time. And Kanchelskis is absolutely up there. And again, like, it's slightly after the book, but I've got a massive, massive soft spot for Juan Verón. And he didn't exactly flourish at United, but I'm so glad he played for United. And I will always remember some of his passes and some of his goals more than players who scored hundreds of goals for us, because of the way he made me feel.
It's an incredible read, an incredible listen. I really enjoyed it, I must say. And it just the tension with City is there all the time. The Brian Kidd, and then this other guy over here, and that Peter Schmeichel, and this guy over here, and Mark Hughes, who was your first footballing hero.
Yeah, first footballing hero and first player that I went off rapidly. Yeah. But again, it's with United fans. There's this thing of like, there's Mark Hughes who used to play for us, Spark Hughes, and then there's Leslie Hughes who went on to Sport City and was just this kind of like bitter old man. So who looked like
his half brother,
a member of the home and away cast.
for anyone thinking of buying the book as well, just even for the chapter titles, like, there's for anyone who's ever been in the Stretford End or in a pub around Old Trafford before a match, there's a famous chant, "Hello, hello, we are the Busby Boys." There's a chapter called "Halal, Halal, we are the Muslim Boys," which is just the greatest play on words I've ever heard. So even for the chapter titles alone, Noz, I think it's worthwhile.
I think any self-respecting United fan needs to get out and buy this, and I'm not, and I thoroughly enjoyed it as well, so there's something in for everybody. It's called Enchilá United, and available at good and bad bookstores, online, audio bookstores, all of the above. Noz, it's always a pleasure. Thanks a million.
Thanks a lot, and thank you for not mentioning the game last night. I appreciate it.
we ran out of time. We were like, we'd set aside 7 minutes at the top of the show to pour over, to pick through those 7 or 8 minutes specifically. We'll do that again. Thanks a million.
All right, see you.
Thanks a lot. Noz Choudry. It's called Enchilá United, and as I said, available at all bookstores. Now, it's 20 to 10, OTB AM, which let Labs get the ultimate shave or your money back, Neon Night Edition, available now on Monday's show. It's going to be the Jet Labs performance rankings. Alison Miller will review Ireland's game against Italy. Anthony Moyles on the weekend's football. Alan Quinlan on the URC, and that'll be live from South Africa. We'll have reaction to the Premier League as well, and that's pretty much it from us for the minute. Shane, good man.
Cheers, Adrian.
Fair play. Stuff. Enjoy the weekend. And I know you're off to a game. Are you reporting? Are you?
No, I'm there in a personal capacity in Healy Park in Omagh.
You're doing like a corporate gig or something?
No, just there. Shaking hands, you know, Tyrone Monaghan. Looking forward to it.
Fiona Tomas right now, author of that Telegraph article in the Irish Review during the week. She was talking to Richie on last night's show. Have a fab weekend.
Welcome back to the show. It's Richie McCormack here with you this evening. Now, an article in the Telegraph today claimed that a culture of sexism pervades in Irish rugby, even in the year 2023. And a couple of days out from their third outing in the TikTok Women's Six Nations against Italy in Parma. The author of that article is Fiona Tomas, and she joins us on the line. Fiona, good evening to you.
Hi, Richie. How are you doing?
Nice to have you along. I'm always intrigued by the germ of something. And what was the... I guess the starting point for you, without wanting to have revealed sources, etc., for this particular article?
Yeah, I was asked this question earlier today, actually, on another pod. And to be frank with you, it was really just watching Nicola Friday, the Irish captain, after that loss to France last week in the Women's Six Nations, where I guess your listeners will be familiar with what happened. Ireland went out and they kind of got pummeled by 14-woman France there were 14 women down, I think, for a good hour or so. And just seeing kind of Nicola's reaction after the match, it was so genuine. It was so authentic. You can see she's a very passionate, hardworking female athlete. And she just looked, she was so emotional. And I sort of kind of spotted similarities with the interview that Siobhan Lillycrap, the former Welsh captain, gave sort of at this point exactly 2 years ago before the Welsh Rugby Union rolled out contracts for its side. And it really sort of set something within me. And I thought, well, you know, the sort of lack of support that the Irish Rugby Football Union has given its female athletes over the past, well, two and a bit years, really, with the failure of the team to not qualify for last year's World Cup. It's been well documented. And I just sort of wanted to kind of dig a bit deeper, really, to sort of see what's been going on, really, and how it's come to this, how it has come to the fact that these women are sort of being sent out to fail in a way.
Yeah, it's been an interesting decade, I guess, since Ireland won that Grand Slam in 2013. The rugby team has probably been on a journey that it never wanted to encounter, I guess, and there's been a lot of authors of that particular story, and a lot of them would come from on high, and how the team was cared for or not, as your piece kind of discovers as well.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you mentioned that team there, that iconic team of 2013 who went out and won that slam. And, you know, those were the sort of glory days, weren't they, for Irish World Rugby. And, you know, all those teams in the Women's Six Nations have been on a journey as such since then. And, you know, over here in England, we've certainly been on a sort of triumphant and heartbreaking journey at the same time, with the Red Roses obviously losing that amazing final to New Zealand in the World Cup last year. What I would say is that, you know, as someone who reports a lot on women's rugby and women's sport, you know, I see the likes of England go out and wallop teams kind of week in, week out. And they have been doing that, obviously, in this year's Six Nations as well. And I sort of fear what the scoreline will be when they come to Cork in, the week after next. It's kind of striking the way that our own union, the Rugby Football Union, has sort of mapped out this kind of path for our women's team over here, compared to the lack of mapping out that the Irish Union has done. You know, we've got the Sugar Babes playing at Twickenham at the end of this month. Nearly 50,000 tickets have nearly been sold for that match at Twickenham. And you look at kind of where, like, the state of the game is in Ireland, with a lot of players having left the country to come over and play their club rugby over here. You know, and you know, the allegations that I kind of uncovered in the Telegraph piece today about, you know, players being denied just simple things like protein supplements, you know, in the build-up to their Japan tour last year. And you just think, what? Like, this is crazy.
On that particular issue, the IRFU have pointed out that they have since employed, I think it was the start of February, in around that direction, that they employed Emma Brennan as a full-time nutritionist for the women's 15 side. So you would imagine that issues like that have indeed been rectified.
I would certainly like to think so, Richie. But then, you know, when you hear what you just said there, it's 2023, and only now have they just appointed the squad's first full-time nutritionist. I mean, I wouldn't know how long Ireland men have had a full-time nutritionist for, but I bet it's been longer than February this year, you know. And that's where the kind of sexist attitudes, I think, tend to pervade. It's like, you know, why are we taking this long? These basic building blocks to be put in, you know, put in place for the women's team, which are automatically a kind of given for the men, or have been a given for the men.
I know it's not stipulated in your piece. Can you give any indication of whether that player who was denied protein seemingly on that Japan tour, whether they're still involved in the Irish setup?
They're still involved, but I would be reluctant to say any more than that, because I don't want to get any sort of hassle.
Yeah.
To put it mildly.
The contract issue is an interesting one as well, because there were 30 odd contracts offered to players last year. I think 27 took them up, and they ranged from 15,000 to 30,000 in terms of salaries. The issue within the article is that there wasn't a hybrid contract on offer to players who might necessarily be in a position, like 15 to 30 grand isn't going to pay the rent in Dublin, that's quite clear to anybody at the moment. But there wasn't an opportunity for those who might want to tally that with their own outside work for them to pursue that opportunity.
Yeah, and that was one of the kind of really surprising things, I think, that kind of emerged from my kind of journalism, the fact that, you know, this was a specific request, as I understand, you know, among many of the players. We're kind of at a funny junction in women's rugby at the minute, especially if you think about it in Ireland, where, you know, they haven't quite made that full-time switch yet. to kind of complete professionalism like we have with England over here. I mean, even at club level over here, there's a lot of talk about, you know, which model which model best suits your kind of elite women's rugby player in this day and age. Is it sort of to go full time to be that professional athlete, or is it a sort of half and half situation where you kind of have a dual career situation going on? So you kind of you're constantly enriching kind of one part of your life through whatever that might be, away from rugby, and then you have your rugby playing side to it. So I think, I know that was a kind of request from the group, and it sort of fell on deaf ears, unfortunately. It was a sort of, no, you've got to be in Dublin or not.
How many were involved in that group that wanted the hybrid contracts, or wanted to at least have that discussion?
I wouldn't be able to put a number on it, Richie, but I understand it to be, obviously, it was well aired, you know, as a sort of it was raised. And this sort of goes back to the whole point about, any decision that a union takes, you know, it's got to be sort of player led. You know, players at the end of the day have got to be at the heart of the decision making process, because they're the ones who are living and breathing and, you know, and playing the rugby. And for example, it's quite concerning that on the whole white shorts debacle, very topical in women's sport at the minute, with, you know, our Lionesses over here recently switching their white shorts. You know, to hear that was just to sort of, okay, yeah, let's change the short colour without consulting any of the players. You know, that was, again, it's sort of an example of, you know, the sort of apathy, I think, that you know, is sort of being shown towards, you know, women at the minute, you know, these women's players. You know, and I'm not saying, you know, the Irish Union isn't alone in this. You know, it's kind of long kind of plagued other unions, other sporting organisations from, you know, outside of rugby as well. It's a very common thing in women's sport where women aren't listened to. But yeah, that was another big thing.
Take us through that shorts issue, because that's something that popped up, I think, in all of our inboxes a couple of weeks ago, before the Six Nations started, whereby it was announced that the Ireland women's team, I guess in line with a lot of other women's teams across several different sports, had decided to, or it was decided that they will be changing short colour from white to a darker colour, and that's obviously to accommodate players who will be playing while on their period. And that's a completely sensible thing, and seems like a completely overdue scenario that they've actually come to deal with. It turns out that there wasn't actually much player involvement in that, and reading back through the press release that came through, it seemed more of a marketing opportunity for the kit supplier than it did seem the outcome of a lengthy, meaningful discussion, I guess. It doesn't even have to be lengthy, with the players.
Yeah, you kind of hit the nail on the head there completely. Like, I must admit, when I first saw the news drop, before, I think it was the same day as the Women's Six Nations launch at the start of March. It was... Yeah, I missed it. I was surprised, because, you know, I was at the Euros last summer, where I asked Beth Mead, our Lioness striker, about the white shorts and whether she feels comfortable playing in them. And Beth was very vocal about it and said, well, no, actually, it's quite impractical for the team. 8 months later, the FA announced that the team are going to change to blue. So that was a process that took 8 months. And from what I can see, at no point has an Irish women's player ever spoken out publicly about feeling anxious or stressed about having to wear white shorts and play in white shorts when they're on their period. Now, being on your period is a very individual thing as a woman. You know, there might be players within that group who think the switch to navy is brilliant, you know, especially if they're heavy bleeders. But I think the fact that, like you said, it sort of just landed that day in everyone's inbox. There was no sort of timeline of events that were mentioned. There was no sort of names of players who'd kind of driven this initiative. And the more I kind of looked into it, the more I got the sense that, this was a decision that was taken above the players. And that for me is, a real red flag, because, like I said, these sorts of decisions have to be player-led.
Did you manage to put that point to the IRFU?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, and they came back to me on that, and it's reflected in the article. They said that the The issue about playing in white shorts apparently was first raised during the Japan tour last autumn.
Which is fairly recent. It's not like it's a sudden problem or a sudden issue.
No, fairly recent. But if you re-listen to Nicola Friday's interview that she gave at the Women's Six Nations launch, where she was asked at length about the shorts, at no point did she mention the Japan tour.
We've obviously heard from Greg McWilliams today. He's been up in front of the media because that's what happens 2 days out from an international, and they're playing Italy in Parma in the Six Nations. He was asked if indeed he had read your article today.
I read the article. I think it'd be wrong of me to not read the article. And lots of it's historic. You know, it's the same things that you could have talked about last year. You know, when I met David Nusafora in 2021, I started on the 1st of December. He outlined a plan, and everything that we talked about, we're on track. And that's all we can focus on. You know, I was the only full-time staff member on the 1st of December. We now have 7 full-time staff members. We have 8 contractors that come into us for our competition week. We have 8 new employments along our pathway and our centres of excellence. So, like, there's been a massive growth in that time. And to be honest with you, talking about things historically is we can't control, and we can't control the external noise. We can control what we can do. And it's a good lesson. It's a really good lesson for these young players, not just in rugby, but in life, that if you trust in the process of what you're doing and you've got good people around you, I've been really impressed with their resilience I've been impressed with their ability to rise to the challenge of playing Italy. What happened previously, you know, I can't stop people talking about it. And if anything, that's something that, you know, they can talk about all they like. We've got to focus on Italy, and we've got to focus then after Italy, we've got to focus on England, and after England, we've got to focus on Scotland. We have to get better. The Irish public, you know, demand good performances. They've seen that with the men's and the 20 side, and even the under-18s girls' sides were phenomenal last weekend. Is things are happening here. And as a head coach, I absolutely believe in the plan and the direction we're going in, and so do the players. And that's what's really exciting. This is a challenge for us. It's challenging our growth as a group. It's challenging our ability to stay focused. And the reaction has been superb. And I've been really proud and impressed by how they're dealing with that. And it's an interesting article, but again, you know, it's nearly irrelevant at this stage. We're moving forward, and we've got a great plan, and we've got good resources around us.
Fiona, when he regards the article as being irrelevant and being largely constituted of legacy issues, what's your reaction to what Greg McWilliams says there?
I've got a huge amount of sympathy for Greg McWilliams. I think he's got a very difficult job on his hands, and I wouldn't say any of the stuff that I've uncovered is his fault. You know, I think everyone would acknowledge that. He's just trying to do a job. He's just trying to lead a group of players. And, you know, they are incredibly resilient, like you said. What I would say, though, is that I consider it quite ironic how he's labelled all of those allegations historic when he's just sort of, in that press conference today, announced all the kind of supposed strides that the union has made. You know, in the past 2 years, which are kind of no less historic than the kind of allegations that I've uncovered today, if you get what I'm saying. You know, in terms of all the infrastructure and increased investment that the union has poured into its women's team since he joined as head coach in December 2021, that may very well be the case. But what's coming next? What's the future? You know, what does the next bit of investment look like? Now, they're the questions that I would certainly be asking. And look, I understand he has to front up difficult situations like this and put positive spin on things. That's his job. But yeah, I would question, you know, what is the future of this team? Where is it going? Because I think a lot of people want to know.
You pointed, obviously, and it's something that struck me when the first set of teams came in across the Six Nations weekend, the paucity of caps that are down throughout the team. Like, I think the first team selection against Wales, there was only, and this is top of my head, 3 players who had 20 caps or more, and I think it might have gone up to 4 in the next game. So it shows you where the players are at. You mentioned the phrase earlier on in today that they're being sent out to fail at the moment, and there seems to be a not a suggestion, but there seems to be a sense that until these changes and professionalism, even if it's on a very base level, do have a chance to take root, that this is just going to be the lot of the Ireland rugby team for the next while, next year or two at least, and possibly even longer.
Yeah, but I mean, that's the sort of a possibility, I guess, isn't it? If the situation doesn't change anytime soon. I just, you know, I'm currently sat in the WRU Centre of Excellence, and you know, they're playing at a sold out Cardiff Arms Park on Saturday. Why is that? Because they've won their opening two games in the bounce. They've been professional for the past 15 months. You know, I think people have to wake up to the fact that women, we're half the, you know, we're 50% of the world's population. You need to start investing in women. And if you invest in female athletes, they almost certainly deliver. And, you know, those Irish girls will deliver. They just need a bit of love and support at the minute because they're not getting enough. And, you know, like I said, I bring the situation back to over here with England because the RFU, you know, they're doing something right if they can get 50,000 to Twickenham. And like I said, these girls, these women are passionate, hardworking female athletes. They're young, like you say, but, you know, that there's so much potential in there. And I just feel that the longer we kind of keep having these conversations about, you know, things that aren't right and women being denied protein and you know, silly things that could so easily be ironed out, you know, we could be talking about so much more positive stuff. And, you know, I just... Yeah, I'm just a bit tired.
It's understandable. Listen, the WRU is actually a really good example because that's shown what is possible in quite a quick turnaround, because they obviously would have entered into professionalism themselves and offering contracts, and similarly there's an avenue for players to go and play in the Premier 15s as well. So it shows particularly what is capable. Not even
OTB AM.